an outline of what the philosophers thought and Christians taught on the subject. FV and AMP, LT, S, BV and AMP, LT, GRS meet editor of The Quest, author of Thrice Greatest Hermes, One Fragment of a Faith Forgotten, Echoes from the Gnosis, etc. 506,290 IA, 4A and AMP, GT, London, Jaden Watkins, 21, Cecil Court, London, WC2, 1919. Contents. IPROEM2. The Spirit Body 3. The Radiant Body IV. The Resurrection Body V. Epilogue. Page 145-75. 110-140. PROEM. The notion that the physical body of man is as it were the exteriorization of an invisible subtle embodiment of the life of the mind is a very ancient belief. Conjectures concerning it vary with every stage of culture and differ within every stage. But the underlying conception invariably holds its ground and makes good its claim to be one of the most persistent persuasions of mankind in all ages and climes. It is, however, the prevailing habit of the skeptical rationalism of the present day to dismiss summarily all such beliefs of antiquity as the baseless dreams of a pre-scientific age, and to dump them all indiscriminately into the midden of exploded superstitions. But this particular superstition, I venture to think, cannot be justly disposed of in so contemptuous a fashion. To the subtle body not only do the acute intellects who upheld it in the past, dispose one to a favorable consideration of their plea that a far-reaching truth underlies this worldwide contention, but I am persuaded that, the more deeply modern research penetrates into the more recondite regions of biology, psychophysiology and psychology, the more readily will reason be inclined to welcome the notion as a fertile working hypothesis to coordinate a considerable number of the mental, vital and physical phenomena of human personality which otherwise remain on our hands as a confused and inexplicable conglomerate. The notion of a subtle embodiment seems admirably fitted to provide a middle ground on which what, at present, are mutually exclusive views, may be focused and brought into helpful cooperation. It may indeed prove to be that mediating ground in concrete reality which is so badly needed to provide a basis of reconciliation between the two dominant modes of opposed and contradictory abstractionizing that characterize the spiritualistic and material. Istic philosophy of to present day the two exclusively subjective theorizing of the one and the two exclusively objective speculation of the other. And indeed the time seems ripe for a favorable revision of this ancient hypothesis, for already there are many signs that the most recent idealistic and most recent realistic movements of thought are beginning to approximate more closely to one another on a number of important points. It is beginning to be seen on all sides that the physical, the biological and the psychological activities of man as a unitary reality are so intimately interblended that no arbitrary selection of any one of these standpoints can provide a satisfactory solution of the nature of the concrete whole which human personality presents. The old-fashioned materialism, which reached its culminating stage in the latter half of the last century, is now generally discredited, if not dead and buried. The ever more subtle analysis of matter is revealing well-nigh boundless vistas of. For the subtle body hitherto undreamed of possibilities locked up within the bosom of nature, ever more subtle and potent modes of energy that may ere long be made available for our use. It is now a general persuasion in scientific circles that the static conception of matter, which wants nothing, physical nature is found to be dynamic through and through, even when the method of research still insists upon arbitrarily abstracting the matter of our great mother from her life and mind. If then much of what we shall have to adduce about the nature of the subtle embodiment of man from the records of the most brilliant period of philosophic thinking in the ancient Western world may seem to invariably purport to be a corporeal entity, and not with the soul proper, much less with the mind, both of which high philosophy asserts to be immaterial realities, Man's subtle body is of the material order, but of a more dynamic nature than his reign supreme, explains idealist and abstractionist subjective to materialistic. They would do well to reflect that we are dealing with what? PROEM5, physically sensible frame. It pertains to the normally invisible. Nevertheless, the latest concepts of modern physics come in as a potent aid in elucidating the most enlightened ancient notions on this subject. We're not here concerned with the naive dreams of the primitives, who envisaged it crudely as a thin replica of the gross body, as the diaphanous double of the dense frame as it appeared to their physical senses. Our concern is with the views of thinkers who conjectured its fundamental constitution to be of the nature of a dynamic system of energy, in a manner that is by no means so foreign to the way in which we are now being taught to regard the underwork of all natural objects by the ever more assured results of electronic analysis. Though then we have the advantage today of basing this ancient hypothesis on the demonstrated concrete facts of positive physical scientific research, we must in justice admit that there is nothing so very original in the concepts we are forced to adopt in endeavoring to explain the facts. We cannot legitimately say they are alto. 6. The subtle body gather hitherto undreamed of novelties in the history of human thought. For as a fact of history we find that innumerable thinkers in the past were persuaded of the existence of the order of matter. It was, for them, superphysical, so to say. It is true that they arrived at their hypothesis by a simpler, if you will even the more naive, procedure than that now used in our modern laboratories. They got that by the analysis of the whole of living experience without prejudice, by speculating on the phenomena of dreams and visions as well as on the facts of purely objective sense data, by reasoning on what happened to them without any arbitrary exclusion of everything not given in patent physical perception. They arrived at their conclusions in what many today in their fancied superiority may be pleased to regard as an unscientific fashion. Nevertheless, in their endeavor they seem to me to have got at some facts which are still deserving of the respectful attention of the open-minded. The difference seems to be that what? PROEM7 was in the past a speculation determined mainly by biological and psychological considerations, has now to some extent been brought within the domain of exact physical observation. We are beginning to realize that all our finely drawn analyses of those intellectual abstractions from the full concrete reality of life which we classify as the physical, biological and psychological orders of exist life and the concrete reality of living refuse to yield up their secret to the scrutiny of even the most subtle intellectual analysis. No summation of the elements into which human ingenuity has analyzed the nature of things, and much less the nature of man, will ever give us again the whole of the reality with which we started. Nevertheless, every effort to explore more deeply the nature of the embodiment of the life of the mind gives us satisfaction in that it is a healthy exercise of the rational functions, are inadequate, together, to give us that sufficient knowledge of ourselves and of our fellows which we so earnestly desiderate, even when taken. 8. The subtle body shine of our unitary selfhood, and is therefore of unquestioned advantage to us as creatures of knowledge. No excuse then need be offered for the following 3 essays which attempt to give a brief sketch of the most interesting presentation of the subtle body notion in the history of its development in Western tradition. They might perhaps be called studies in Alexandrian psychophysiology, for Alexandria was the chief center of philosophic culture for the period under review. If, however, it be objected that Alexandrian is not sufficiently precise a term, seeing that this most famous city of the Hellenistic schools was the meeting ground of many diverse and the battleground of many contradictory traditions and movements of thought, then Platonic may be substituted. For indubitably the views enunciated are throughout dominated by the spirit of that great tradition in its most highly developed period. Moreover, the consideration of a topic which played a very important part in later PROEM9 Platonic thought is not inopportune, for we seem to be entering on a period of a powerful renaissance of Platonic studies in their wider sense, and already keen interest has been aroused by some recent publications of first-class merit and importance. To mention the chief of these only, both on later Platonism, Vavanoan or Hans, the excellent works of Mr. Thomas II, purely philosophical point of view, Mr. Whitaker writes, p. 209, Whitaker 1 and of Dean evaluating the work of the school from a meta regard to some special problems, is our theory of knowledge. End quote. The Neoplatonic thought is, physically, the maturest thought that the European world has seen. Our science, indeed, is more developed, and so also, with end quote. On the other hand, the modern time has nothing to show comparable to a continuous quest of truth about reality during one the Neoplatonists, a study in the history of Hellenism, second and revised edition, with a supplement on the commentaries of Proclus, 1918, to the philosophy of Plotinus, the Guilford Lectures, 1917-1918, 2 volumes, 1919, England. 10. The subtle body, a period of intellectual liberty that lasted for 1,000 years. What it has to show, during the much shorter period of freedom, consists of isolated efforts, bounded by the national limitations of its schools. Be worth examining in no merely antiquarian spirit. Q.U.O.T. The Dean of St. Paul's goes further. He boldly declares himself a disciple of Plotinus, and avers that he has attempted to deal with Neoplatonism as a living and not as a end quote. End quote. The essential of the ontology of Plotinus and Proclus may still ideas, therefore, philosophical end quote, to consider what its dead value is for us in the 20th century philosophy, 2. 219. What that value is, in doctoring as jug be seen his declaration by end quote, we, meant, may cannot preserve Platonism without Christianity, nor Christianity without Platonism, end quote, 2. 227. Both of these distinguished writers, however, have paid scant attention to the special subject to be treated. We hope, nevertheless, that what follows will show nor civilization without both. PROEM 11 that in some respects it is still worthy of attention. It is with this strictly limited point of view that I propose chiefly to deal, for the general subject is of vast extent, indeed of an encyclopedic nature. Apart from the vast material setting forth primitive conceits and fancies, as surveyed by the busy industry of anthropological research, the history of the development of the doctrine of the subtle body by minds of even if it were confined higher culture, solely to Western tradition, would require a very bulky volume, while its parallel evolution in Eastern tradition, even if Indian thought alone, in which it reached its most mature expression, were submitted to review, would demand a still more bulky tome. It may, however, be of interest to glance for a moment at two of its obscure aspects in the Occident. The subtle body notion may be said without exaggeration to have been what might be called the very soul of astrology and alchemy, those amazing twin births of human conception which so fascinated the minds of their beginners, and 12. The subtle body led captive the learned world for so many centuries. The moderns, as we all know, have gone to the other extreme, and cast out the pair of them with contumely as bastards unworthy to company with the legitimate offspring of their eugenically engendered scientific family. The astral or sidereal religion of antiquity revolved round the central notion of an intimate correspondence between man's psychical and sensible apparatus, or his inner embodiment, and the subtle nature of the universe. The relative positions of the celestial bodies in the sether at any moment were regarded by the most advanced thinkers solely as indices of the harmonious interaction of invisible spheres with appropriate fields of vital energy. The ground conviction of astral religion held that there was a subtle organon of great nature, an interior economy of the world soul. Man's nature was so to say an excerpt from this greater nature, and it was conceived of as a germ or seed as it were of the universal tree of life. Man was the microcosm of the macrocosm. PROEM 13 soaring far beyond the dross of vulgar horoscopy, Philosophic astral theory set up a ladder of ascent from the earth to the light world. As it climbed the successive rungs of this scale of ascent, the speculation of sidereal faith rose to ever more sublime heights, and brought such minds as could struggle to the topmost peaks of the Mount of Contemplation into communion with the ever-living ideas or realities of the spiritual state which energized in the second degree as the formative principles of the world of becoming. Munion, we are told, had firmly planted his feet on what Plato calls the plane of truth. So at any rate did the best of them teach concerning the path of ascent, and such did they declare the end of their endeavor to be. The subject of the origin and development of astrology in the wider and higher meaning of the term, both as the pre-scientific forerunner of astronomy and as a topic in the comparative study of religion, has of late received much attention from scholars. He who could reach to such calm. 14. The subtle body with alchemy, however, it is far otherwise, and the reason is not far to seek. The material which astrological tradition offers for our scrutiny is in general straightforward enough. There is no disguise either of its data or of its dogmas. Alchemy, on the other hand, has used every device that human ingenuity and perversity could invent to camouflage out of all recognition its subject matter and procedure. The general impression made on my own mind by a fairly extensive survey of its literature is that the typical alchemist would sooner commit suicide than commit himself to a plain straightforward statement concerning his art. The alchemists and alchemistical philosophers were, however, by no means genuine enthusiasts for secrecy, for then they would have held their tongues and never dipped a pen in ink. They were on the contrary adepts at self-advertisement, though at the same time their elaborate window dressing consisted invariably of substitutes for the precious goods in which they professed to deal. Never in the history of human PROEM-15 culture has there been evidence of so long continued a conspiracy to disguise the subject matter and operative processes of an art. And therefore, in spite of their pretense of conferring priceless benefits by so devious and topsy-turvy a disclosure of the hidden mysteries of nature and of man, they cannot escape the charge, not only always of intentional obscurity, but also frequently of deliberate misleading of the honest inquirer. The excuse they proffered in mitigation of the charge brought against their procedure was that they were compelled so to act in order to safeguard the inner mysteries of their craft from profanation at the hands of the vulgar, the curious and the unworthy. But this plea cannot be accepted as clearing them from the accusation of thereby also at the same time piling up stumbling blocks in the way of the serious, the earnest and the worthy. Doubtless knowledge, especially of the subtle forces of matter and activities of life and mind, gives power, and possession of power is invariably abused by the unra. 16. The subtle body generate and degenerate. But the antidote to such abuse of power is the still deeper knowledge of regeneration, and this is especially, and contradictorily enough, what the best of our alchemists professed to possess as their central secret. There were apparently four phases of transmutation: physical, psychical, vital and spiritual in the high sense of the last term. There can be no doubt that bungling experiments on one's own body, life and mind are fraught with great danger. But in every pursuit of knowledge risks must be taken, if there is to be any progress. The gravamen of the charge against the alchemists is that their elaborate camouflage increased the risks, and led the vast majority of the inexperienced into greater difficulties than they would have had to face if the way had been made clear for them by frank and straightforward statements. I do not propose to inquire whether in the lowest phase of the art any of its practicers really succeeded in making gold or discovering a physical elixir of life, if indeed PROEM-17 such a notion as the latter is not a patent contradiction in terms. Chemistry, as we all know, has dethroned alchemy from its once high estate and exiled it from the realm of science, just as astronomy has superseded astrology and driven it out of the scientific state and contumely. But even as there was a deeper, more vital side of astrology, a subtler phase intimately bound up with the highest themes of sidereal religion, so there was a superphysical, vital and psychical side to alchemy Iscaliophas and Lieting Phenolitoman-esque perfection in spiritual reality. Indeed, with regard to the real work of the craft, its greatest adepts are never weary of asserting that their elements and metals, their apparatuses and operations, are all invariably philosophic. The earth, for instance, is the philosophic earth which no man has ever seen. Their gold and mercury, their black crow, red lion and yellow dragon, are philosophic. These are all things subtle, agents and patients, states and processes, invisible to be. 18. The subtle body mortalize. The colors are symbolic states of the unseen life of the body, indicative of its inner natural transformations, but intensified, hastened and quickened by the attentive supervision of human art. And so with their baths and retorts, with their fermentations, putrefactions, decoctions and concoctions, and baking and calcination and the rest, their concern, they declare, is ever with the asterisk of the outer which spirit's appearances constitute the gross bodies of things. They would seek to know and control the subtle and vital formative principles of objective nature. They declare that the asterisk are perscrutinators of the soul of nature. Here then we see that the notion of a subtle embodiment of the life of the mind is with them a fundamental dogma. The prime secret of alchemical transmutation was an inner mystery, the purgation and perfecting of this subtle embodiment. The best authorities strenuously deny that they are dealing with the vulgar metals, plants or herbs, the patent birds, beasts or fishes of common sense, with overt boiling furnaces, alembics. PROEM 19, the gross alembic, in which the inner work of transmutation was wrought, was the physical body of man. The fervor of his attentive brooding was the fire which had to be so watchfully maintained and warily grated for the hatching out of the spiritual manchic from the mysterious philosophic egg of his subtle nature. Thus the wild riot of symbol, myth and allegory in which they delighted, was intended by the best of them to set forth the sequence of a natural inner process of the life of the soul. All such puzzling devices, when rightly interpreted, they held, would be found to fit into an ordered whole, which told the story of the development of man as inner nature as it could be intensified and quickened by the deliberate application to it of the knowledge of the greatest of all arts, namely, the purification and reorganizing of man as psychical apparatus and the perfecting of the life of his spiritual selfhood. There is, I believe, a considerable measure of truth in this contention. Boutwath. 20. The subtle body alchemists do not explain this, why they took so much trouble to disguise and mask so heavily what is best in their undertaking, and to conceal under so provoking a welter of asterisk what had elsewhere camouflaged already been set forth with comparative simplicity and praiseworthy straightforwardness. For their grand secret was the soul-freeing doctrine of regeneration, which as a demonstrable fact of history was undisguisedly the chief end not only of the higher mystery institutions but of many an open philosophic school and saving cult of later antiquity. The making public of knowledge concerning this high end of human endeavor, it is true, had for long been placed under the most severe tabus. Everything concerning it was wont to be guarded with jealous secrecy, and noses of this order was strictly reserved for the elect, who had first been thoroughly approved by rigid testing of their courage and character. But, if I am not entirely misled by my reading of history, the widespread spiritual ferment at the beginning of our era shows. PROEM 21 that the power of this hitherto uncased T1 taboo had begun to be broken down, and this, as I believe, because it had not simply been overruled by the necessities of intellectual honesty but abrogated spiritually by a more than human authority. This inner authority of an enlightened conscience was imminent in the outpouring of the spirit of the Lord of Life, which stirred the hearts of men to their depths and changed the minds of large numbers. It signified the birth of a new dispensation, and inaugurated a drastic departure from any of the old ways. Webb's finding boldly declared that the things which had hitherto been whispered in the secret places were now to be proclaimed on the house. There was to be an inner transvaluation of values and an outer change in religious method. Thus the keynote of a new spiritual order was struck for those who had ears to hear. The sovereignty of the Spirit was the burden of the glad tidings. The kingdom of eternal values was foreshadowed, and the realm of perduring ends declared to be man's tops. 22. The subtle body true goal, whatever his station in life might be. Now if in fact this new order issued from above, if it was really an authentic pronouncement of right reason, if in other words it was a wise and deliberate abolition of the ancient taboo, arid the just condemnation of that artificial secrecy which was now recognized by the spirit of man that goeth upward to be a hindrance and no longer a help to human progress, then the vital and moral basis for the future reconstruction of society could be assured only by a loyal acceptance of the new liberty by all classes of the end quote. Have we community? Freely you is the watchword. And indeed there can be no doubt that when the better way of utter honesty and outspokenness has been followed in full sincerity of heart and openness of mind, as in the case, for instance, of modern Sefford, freely give science, achieved enormous results have been in quote, viewed in the light of the new liberty proclaimed some 1900 years ago. The alchemists, in my opinion, must PROEM 28 then be judged to have followed throughout their career a policy of reaction. No matter how piously disposed many of them professed to be, and some indubitably were, they cannot escape the charge of fighting against the light by obscuring it. For what else did they in general effect by their secretive and deceptive methods than to darken the face of heaven and shut out the sunlight with their clouds of confusing symbolism? They hid their undertaking with such dense smoke screens that they have no one but themselves to thank for their art still being wrapped in an impenetrable fog of misconception. Historians excusably fight shy of tackling so obscure and evasive a subject, and so it is not surprising to find that as yet the history of alchemy has met with no competent scribe. Indeed, it is difficult to chronicle, even in its purely external aspects, for the recognized literature of the Western tradition alone is exceedingly voluminous. As to its origins, I venture to think that 24. The subtle body, one of its most important sources, has so far not even been noticed. I would therefore here add a very brief note by way of suggesting how alchemy in its most characteristic vulgar form may be found to link up with traditions of far greater worth and dignity. It was somewhere about the 11th century that the art appeared full-fledged in the West, in a Latin Europe that had long been cut off from all connection with the direct tradition of Greek culture. It came, as so much else came, by means of Latin translations from the Arabic, by way of the schools of Moorish Spain, which played so important a part in the intellectual development of Europe after the night of the Dark Ages. These philosophers and thinkers of Islam derived their culture in the first instance directly from the schools of Hellas. They got their alchemy in like fashion from the Byzantine tradition of the art. When nascent Mohammedan culture first met with it, the craft already claimed to be the tradition of the Hermetic art par. PROEM 25 excellence. Egypt was held to be its source and origin, and Egyptian Hermes its revelator and patron. But is this claim really legitimate? As far at any rate as we can now control such statements historically, this particular pretension of alchemy seems, in my opinion, for the most part to be somewhat wide of the mark. In the first place, I am unaware that any alchemical treatise, or even the hint of one, has as yet been found in hieroglyphic, Demotic or Coptic script. As to the genuine treatises of the trees one preserved in the Greek corpus, and the excerpts and fragments associated with the honorific title Thrice Great as Hermes, they are entirely innocent of alchemy in the way that the Byzantine texts of the craft present it. The trismegistic texts know nothing of gold-making, or of the elixir of life, or of the philosopher as stone. These Byzantine Greek texts which have megistic hermetic tradition one semi thrice greatest Hermes, 3 volumes, dot, comma, London, comma, 1906. 26. The subtle body only comparatively recently been collected, edited and translated by Berthelot, and one rule, it should be remembered, were practically unknown to all our medieval alchemists. Theodinet referred to Greek texts. If now we take the most authentic group of these documents, that is to say, the only one that contains treatises which are not all plainly pseudonymous, the writings ascribed to Zosimus, who lived in the 4th, what do we find? We find an admired confusion of dross and preciousness. We find gold making, recipes for substitute alloys feigning gold, quaint prescriptions of the workshops of the craftsmen, intermingled with the high doctrines of a spiritual philosophy. The main burden, indeed, of the exhortations of the genuine Zosimus to his pupil, the Lady Theozewaia, is that, if she would know the truth, she should betake herself for refuge to Semanders, the spiritual shepherd of men, with whom those who were directly taught of God, those known one collection CHS Anklin's Alchemist at Grex, 3 volumes, Paris, 1888, century AD. Proem 27 by the generic title Thrice Greatest Hermes, commune and baptize herself in the life of the divine mind. Zosimus quotes at length from authentic, and some otherwise unknown, Trismegistio works, and in so doing rises high above the beggarly elements of the goldmakers and fakers. Why then, we ask in amazement, should a genuinely mystical philosopher, who was clearly a member of some Semenders community, mix himself up with what must have been for him so paltry a concern as gold-making? It seems then only reasonable to reject the gold-making treatises ascribed to our as clearly pseudonymous, just as is the case with others, as when, for instance, we find the great names of a Democritus or of an Aristotle filched to father the sorry offspring of far lesser minds, inquirers not infrequently of recipes that are first cousins to the contents of a magical medicine bag, though it is highly probable that the few strangely arresting visions of graphic hermetic Gnostic. 28. The subtle body symbolism we meet with in this group of documents should be ascribed to Zosimus himself. It is well nigh impossible for one who is a student of the genuine hermetic treatises to believe that a knower of this simple, straightforward philosophy and high mysticism of the Trismegistic school could have deliberately lent himself to the tortuous devices and deceits of the most vulgar side of alchemy. In any case, it is sun clear that the latter has nothing whatever legitimately to do with thrice greatest Hermes. But is alchemy in any sense of Egyptian origin? It may very well be that in its lowest aspect it derived partly, maybe even to a large extent, from the workshops of Egyptian craftsmen. The higher side of it, in so far as this had connection with all the great traditions of regeneration, may also be sought for in part in the far-famed wisdom of ancient Egypt, though clear alchemical traces are not easy to come across in this direction. Its definitely characteristic psychical heredity, so to say, is more easily traceable. Proem 29 to another source by some clearly marked out channels. Now the two great wisdom traditions of antiquity were for the Greeks those of Babylonia and of Egypt. Let us then set our faces in the direction of all that Babylon so vaguely stood for in Hellenistic days. We shall thus find our quest after the psychical heredity of alchemy leading us to Syria and thither Asia, to later Babylonian and Chaldean sources, blended with Persian Magian traditions. If Greek genius, in the Hellenistic period, philosophized the ancient wisdom of Egypt, it also philosophized this Arano-Babylonian mystical syncretism. Indeed, if we accept Plotinus on the purely negative ground that the Aeneids make scant reference to the subject, all of the philosophers of the later Platonic school, as is well known, took quite an absorbing interest in the mystery lore enshrined in what were most generally referred to as the 1 My Chaldean Oracles, 2 volumes, London, 1908, in the series Echoes from the Gnosis, Chaldean Oracles. 30. The subtle body. In 1894 Kral proved in masterly fashion that all the scattered fragments of quotations, accepted as genuine and referred to this origin in the O-Platonic writings, were taken from Manasa Earth. This is a Hellenistic poem which provided the subject matter of voluminous commentaries by a number of the most distinguished members of the school. Unfortunately, the commentaries themselves have now all been lost. When then we find that men of such high philosophical equipment and critical ability as a Porphyry or a Proclus thought so highly of the contents of this poem, and accepted it as enshrining the genuine dogmas of the ancient and valuable traditions of the wisdom of the sages of Galdria, the subject seems well worthy of our attention. Among other things, this famous poem sets forth a highly mystical doctrine concerning the nature of the subtle body, and of the soul and mind of man, and purports to reveal the mystery of the divine paternal fire and the secret of the life of the Great Mother. It is preeminently a doctrine of the living. POEM 31 fire and all its works, its transmutations and transformations, and also a manual of liturgical lore and discipline. As such, it is obviously an alchemistic treatise in the higher sense of the term. Here then we have a clearly marked channel leading to one of the main streams of origin of the later alchemical art. Some of the Christian Gnostic schools, moreover, in like fashion supply us with indications of the psychical heredity of the higher alchemy, and this too not obscurely, but sometimes very plainly, in that they employ a symbolism identical with that of the later art. For instance, in one form of the so-called Ophite tradition, we find the metals associated with the planetary spheres. And in another we read of the mysterious stone which has its mystical implications set forth by free use of quotations from both the Old and the New Testaments. But it is in the borderland region, in the link between Tychism and the definitely Christianized Gnosis, that the clearest indication of the pre-Christian Syrian Gnos. 82 The subtle body line of descent of the higher alchemy is to be found. We find it permeating the doctrines of one whom the later church fathers looked back to as the originator of all the Gnostic heresies which they denounced in such unmeasured terms, in the tradition associated with the name of Simon the or one Omegas Magian, title that connects his teachings immediately with a Chaldeo-Persiae background. The chief document of the Simonian school, which we can now recover from the quotations of the heresiologist Hippolytus, is most probably a later redaction of the Gnosis of the Magian teacher, due it may be to the high literary ability and philosophical and mystical insight of Valentinus. This great denouncement, as it is entitled, presents us with a highly developed doctrine of the divine fire and of the tree of life, and with psychophysiological speculations which are entirely in keeping with the subtle body theory of psychical alchemy. It is then, in my opinion, not only Prob 1 Say Simon 1892, Nemagod, London, Proem 83 able, but capable of reasonable demonstration, that the syncretic gnosis associated with the name of Simon the Magian is indicative of one of the main streams of the psychical heredity of early alchemy. Now the Simonian document tells us that in quote, of all the which both con things are, sailed and manifested, that is intelligible and sensible, or spiritual and natural, the super-celestial fire is the treasure house, as it were a great tree, like that seen by Nabuchodonosor in vision, from which all flesh is nourished. Ampersand QUOT. Here we have the tradition of a grandiose symbolism plainly connected with Babylonian mystery lore and the spiritual side of the Perso-Magian fire cult. Moreover, in this connection our attention is specially called to one of the most striking visions of the Jewish apocalyptic book of Daniel. Now this arresting document of the Old Testament, which has so persistently fascinated the minds of uncritical believers in prophecy for so many centuries, and given birth to the ever-new feverish expectancy. The subtle body teons of so many latter-day sects has been scientifically first pointed out by the Platonist Porphyry in the 3rd century. It was in 170 and again in 168 BC that Antiochus Epiphanes, the Hellenistic Lord 34 shown beyond all question by biblical research to be a late pseudonymous document written about 165 BC, as was and defiled the temple and violently endeavored of Syria, took Jerusalem, profaned to root out the Jewish religion. To the revolt of Palestinian Jewry under Mattathias and his heroic sons, the Maccabees and the Ariathnemi of Antiochus, stood for all that was accursed in the history of the Hebrews. The Book of Daniel is certainly an inspired document of its own peculiar order. It is a polemical political writing, in which is depicted in graphic narrative and skillful imagery the triumphant superiority of the holiness of Israel, of the pious seers of the times who succeeded to the tradition of the ancient schools of the prophets of Yahweh. This spiritual triumph was ostensibly at this led. PROM 85, the expense of the Chaldean soothsayer and Magian adepts of the Babylon of the exile. But in reality the polemic was aimed against the Hellenized Orientalism of the Syrian kingdom of Antiochus. The Book of Daniel is the earliest example we now possess of Jewish mystically concealed political controversy, with which national theocratic claims were inextricably interblended, and all set forth in the disguise of a pseudo-historical setting. It is the typical instance of the nature of against Rome, and its method of procedure is characteristic of much in their rich apocalyptic literature, in the pseudo-prophetical setting of the Sibylline oracles, and in no little of the Talmuds. The political opponents of the Jews were, in the belief of these writers, all without exception enemies of God, and the blasphemers against their religion were the execrable servants of Antichrist. Antiochus was the archenemy of the faith. So also had been Nebuchadnezzar, who had that became so common in the Jewish revolt literary camouflage W-thish later on. 36. The subtle body also before him ravaged the Holy Land and enslaved the chosen people of God. The Jewish apocalyptic writers and religio-political scribes were adepts in setting forth typically present events in the guise of past history, and in forecasting the future to suit the hopes and ambitions of a people who believed themselves destined by God for world rule. Their favored preoccupation was to depict their race as the chief element in world history, the protagonist of the world drama, and to show how all had been predestined on their behalf, by setting forth what had occurred or what was occurring as though it were the utterance of prophetical revelation. The Hebrew language so used might almost be said to be possessed of a prophetical tense. Now just as the visions of Ezekiel are strongly tinctured with the imagery of pressed with his imaginal environment, so are the visions and mystical incidents of the Babylonian religious conceits, prophesied in that land of symbolic iconography, and was naturally psychically inferky. PROM 87 Book of Daniel replete with a similar tincturing of symbolism. In it, as we have already seen, we find reference to the graphic image of the world tree. The two other most striking pictures in the narrative are the symbolic monster statues set up by the king who exalted himself to divine honors, that image of the Lord of the world whom he would compel all men to worship, and the fiery furnace into which the three pure ones, the pious servants of the true God, are cast. The gold and silver, the brass and iron, of the typical image of the god of the Aeon can be more immediately referred to the chief alchemical metals than to the four astrological ages of sidereal religion. As to the fiery furnace, which blasts to ashes the servants of the oppressor even though they stand outside it, while the three holy ones, though encircled by its fervent heat, are not only not consumed, but joined by a fourth who in his dazzling radiance is likened unto a son of the gods. Surely all this, as soon as attention is called to it, might be recognized as a suggestive. 88. The subtle body setting forth of one of the sublimer stages of that transmutation with which the higher side of alchemy concerned itself. As far as I am aware, this has not had attention drawn to it before, but I am so greatly struck with this association of ideas, that I venture to think the Book of Daniel could with little difficulty be held to bear testimony to a stage in the psychical heredity of what later on became clothed in the motley in which later alchemy so much delighted. But this is not the last of the footprints leading back to the cave of alchemical origins. Zosimus categorically asserts that the prime secret of the alchemical art was identical with the most hidden mystery of the Mithraica. This indication once again sets our face in the direction of the stream of descent whose channels we are endeavoring to discern. In spite of Kamau's magnificent labors, I venture to think that by no means the last word has been said on the myth recalled. Women into the latter. Both traditions point PROEM 39, or on the mystery tradition associated with the name of this far-famed savior god of antiquity. Nowhere does C.U. Mount in his far-flung researches connect any aspect of the mythical with alchemy. Has altogether overlooked this precise and suggestive statement of Zosimus. Now we know not only that, as has already been pointed out, Neoplatonists were intensely interested in the so-called Chaldean oracles, but that many of them were also initiated into the mysteries of Mithra. The Mithraical were closely connected with the mystery rites of the Magna Mater. The men were initiated into the former, the back to Hither Asia and the Near Orient. Asia Minor and Syria were the hotbeds of such syncretic saving cults. In comparison with the richness of the monuments and inscriptions, we know but little of the doctrines of the religion of Mithra, of the main myth of the birth and life of 40, the heroic deeds of the god and his conquest of the bull and final triumph. We practically know nothing. The figured monuments of the myth, the serial tableau of the labors of the god, have so far remained without even one plausible interpretation. There is, however, a liturgical document, purporting to set forth the innermost personal liturgical rites, in some ways reminiscent of the far-famed yoga practices of India, of this initiatory institution of many degrees. To this liturgical piece is remarkable in any case as being the only complete ritual of the mysteries preserved to us. Diederich, who first rescued the heavily overwritten text from the chaos of the Greek magical papyri, had no doubt of it being in its original form an authentic document of Mithraism and as such of the very first importance for a knowledge of its inner rites. C.U. Mount, however, denies the legitimacy. 1c. My Mysteries of Mithra, London, 1907, in the series Echoes from the Gnosis of C. My Mithriac Liturgy, London, 1907, in the same series. PROEM 41 of Diederich's contention, and the learned world has so far as I know, without exception sided with Cunyant. If, however, I am not greatly mistaken, this unfavorable judgment will have to be seriously reconsidered if not quashed. In any case, the ritual supplies a hint that may lead to the recognition of an ancient element blended into the syncretism of the later Mithra cult, which might prove to be of far-reaching importance. In the symbolic scenes of the rite, typical of certain psychical states accompanying the ascent of the soul of the initiant in his psychical passage to the light world, culminating in his meeting with Mithra himself, the Lord of Light and King of the Divine Fire, there is one which has of late especially arrested my attention. It should be remembered that the whole rite purports undisguisedly throughout to be the liturgical process of regeneration, or the bringing to birth of man's perfected subtle body. At a certain stage in this process of inner transmutation and tightening of Khan. 42. The subtle body Jewishness. The initiant is said to meet with two symbolically depicted companies of supernal powers in the guise of seven youths and seven maidens. The youths are represented as having the heads of bulls. Now the familiar myth of Theseus tells us how the monstrous Minotaur, the legendary bull man who was lord of the mysterious labyrinth of that once prehistoric Crete which has now so startlingly reappeared on the stage of history, exacted from the ancient dwellers of Athens a yearly tribute of seven noble youths and seven high-born maidens. We have here, I venture to think, by no means a chance coincidence. The ancient Minoan religion, as we now know, was dominated by the bull symbolism and was also fundamentally a cult of the Great Mother. I therefore suggest that part of the later Mithra story was reminiscent of the ancient Minoan mythology, and of the legendary lore of a religion of which Grecian history had lost all trace. The subject is, I think, PROEM 48 of a detailed treatment and deserving promises to lead the patient investigator far afield. In any case, it is evident that the above items of suggestion, crude as they are in their brevity, open up a number of very important lines of research. A favilluum could easily be written in support of the thesis I have ventured to put forward. But for the present, I must be content to leave the matter simply as a suggestion of topics of interest that are not unworthy of serious consideration by any courageous pioneer who contemplates writing on the psychical element in the origins of alchemy. Much more could be written indicative of other lines of search in tracing the history of the doctrine of a subtle body in the West, even though it be in the most summary outline. But enough has already been said to serve the modest purpose of this poem, which is briefly to introduce a more detailed consideration of the notions of the most accredited exponents of the doctrine in the classical past. 44 The STJBTLE Body 3, their views are, I believe, in some respects at any rate, not unworthy in our own day of the consideration of such psychologists as are conversant with the fee psychical research, and not nominal without interest for the general reader. The Spirit Body. In this short study I propose to consider briefly, and in its inferior aspect only, the theory of the subtle body of the soul, or man as psychical embodiment, as set forth by the philosophers of the later Platonic narrow sense of the name, and by their more school and the generally accepted immediate predecessors and followers. Many will doubtless think that such opinions deserve no consideration at all in these days of scientific enlightenment, and that they were better left to well-merited oblivion. But though it is true that the physical science of those far-off days is now entirely superseded, I venture to think that perhaps some of the notions of these old thinkers with regard to this idea of a subtle soul vehicle may be still not entirely without interest to those who are either specially engaged in psychical research or generally 45. 46 The subtle body familiar with psychic and psychophysical phenomena. For indeed some of the modern theories put forward to account for certain classes of such phenomena favor a very similar hypothesis. Let us in the first place pay unto Caesar the things that be Caesar's, and cheerfully sacrifice to the godlets of anthropology and primitive culture by admitting that in the beginnings the soul was apparently believed to be air, and our breath, and breath spirit, and spirit and soul one just simply air, and pass on to those who thought far otherwise, laying it down as a fundamental dogma that the human soul was a rational reality or activity, an intelligible life, an immaterial essence, and not body or an embodiment or element of any kind. The loftier side of the subject will be reserved for subsequent treatment, when an attempt will be made to say something about the subtle vehicle or vesture, or better embodiment, of the soul in its purity, the celestial or luciform body, or organon of light, the augoides or astroides, as it was called by our philosophers. The Spirit Body 47 Here we have to deal solely with this vehicle in its obscure or impure state, with its inferior relationships, that is, its connections with the animal soul on the one hand and with the body of flesh on the other. A warning may first of all be given as to terms. We should try to distinguish between living ideas and dead vocables, otherwise we shall be incontinently among the tombs with an amazing and L.T. derangement of epitaphs to mock using the obscurity. The most general term used by these writers for the subtle soul vehicle in its inferior aspect is spirit netima or spiritual body, Soma Numericon and others before and contemporary with him use those terms in a more exalted sense. It may perhaps avoid some confusion if in this connection we speak of the spiritual body or spirit body. The more attractive view, to me at least, seems to have been that, no matter what changes it might undergo, the subtle vehicle was fundamentally one. But this side of the question need not be discussed at present. But as Paul. 48 The subtle body already in such early Christianistic circles as were in touch with Hellenic ideas, the confusion between the higher and lower spirit, or the higher and lower aspects of the spirit, was clearly felt. In the Pistis Sophia, for instance, we find a strong distinction drawn between the pure spirit and the counterfeit spirit, the latter being apparently identical with the parasitic or appended soul of Basilides and his son Isidore. So also with the Astroides, The star-like or sidereal body, this must not be identified with the now popular term astral body, for the latter bears a closer resemblance to the spiritualist body of the Platonists than to their Augoids. Again, the spirit body, or spiritualism, was often called the airy or ethereal body. But, as a distinction was usually drawn between the lower air, and the upper air, aether, ethereal should perhaps be reserved for the celestial state of this psychical vehicle. Occasional iatus pakinotho's nature, that is, the nature of the physical body, embodiment. The spirit body 49, and after death it was known as the image, eidolon, imago, simulacrum, or shade, skia, umbra. Sometimes it was referred to as the subtle or light vehicle of the soul, to distinguish it from the gross, dense, solid or earthy body, which was often called the asterisk shell, or shell-like body or surround, in reminiscence of the famous phrase of Plato in the Phaedrus, 250 C. End quote. We are imprisoned in the body like an oyster in its shell. Ampersand QUOT. Here again confusion may arise for the unwary, for the image has of late been sometimes called asterisk shell. It must, however, be always clearly understood that, for our philosophers, spirit in this sense is subtle body, an embodiment of a finer order of matter than that known to physical sense, and not soul proper. By body, moreover, is not meant developed and organized form, but rather essence or plasm that may be graded, or as it were woven into various textures. In itself unshaped, it is capable of receiving the impression or pattern of any organized form. 50. The subtle body, the soul proper, on the contrary, is thought of as utterly incorporeal. Psychic life is classified according to its manifestations in body, but is not itself body. The most general classification is threefold. 1. Vegetative, as in plants and in the physical bodies of animals and men. 2. Irrational, as in the spiritualist bodies of animals and men. And 3. Rational, in man only. Man has thus, when incarnate, not three souls, but three grades of soul or life, namely, vegetative, irrational and rational. Let us now turn to our documents, first of all glancing through the literature handed down under the aegis of thrice greatest Hermes. The trismegistic tractates, though deeply tinged with Platonism, can hardly in strictness be called later Platonic, according to current opinion, for the larger portion of them may securely be placed earlier than Ammonius Saccas and Plotinus in the 3rd century, who for so long have been considered to be the founders of the Neoplatonic movement proper. The trees. Aspects. Sermon of Isis to Horus 1 we 15, 3, 200. The spirit body 51 magistic tradition can, however, safely be said to have been one of the most immediate predecessors of the Neoplatonic chain. It indubitably links up with it as an integral part of the Platonic movement. In this literature we find the doctrine of the spirit already well developed, and that too both in its spiritual and spiritualist it is with the latter solely, however, that we are here concerned. From one of the earliest tractates, the learned that spirit is, as it were, of the nature of a quintessence or unitary element over against the gross elements of the physical body. The end quote, mixture end quote, of the dense body end quote, is a union and a blend of the four elements, and from this blend and union a certain vapor rises, which is enveloped by the soul, but circulates within the two body. Ampersand QUOT. It is the medium between the soul and one. The second references are to my thrice greatest Hermes, 3 volumes, London, 1906. End quote. And from the union, let breathing together of these four is spirit born, end quote. 2 copy. X. XV. 2, 3. G6. 52 The subtle body, the gross body, and so is said to partake of the nature of both. The exposition is set forth, perhaps unavoidably, in spatial terms and material imagery. Both the spirit and the body, it is to be noted, are in the soul, and not the soul in the spirit. Elsewhere, however, key, in the soul is spoken of as being vehicled in, or on, but as the soul is said to use in quote, we are further told, in the same passage, the spirit, not as its but in quote, as envelope only, but though it were its envelope, there is no real contradiction. Spirit means of veins and arteries and blood, bestows upon the living creature motion. Ampersand QUOT. The writer, however, insists that blood is that in quote, spirit pervading body by not soul or life in quote, as some think. Ampersand QUOD. Blood is that the vehicle of conditions, the end quote, two and it is spirit 1 degree Celsius. H. X. She. 18, 17, 2, 149, 152. To spirit, living creature. Ampersand QUOD. End quote. For Homer knew that blood was the food and element of spirit. Ampersand QUOD. Diogenes Laertius, therefore, seems to be confusing terms when, VI. 31, p. 518, he attributes to the end quote, chat the soul is copy. Vita Homeri, p. 341. Pythagoras' opinion nourished by blood. Ampersand QUOT, it is true that Porphyry also says, to end quote, and nymph, p. 257, ed. Not oak, that souls in generation. 318, it is said that in quote, spirit with which the spirit body 53, thus in an amp, lt, the perfect sermon, vi, 3, 2, they, animal bodies, all are filled, being interblended with the rest, presumably the four elements, doth make them live. Ampersand QUOD, this is based on a general principle laid down in the same treatise, zv, 3, 2, 336, namely, that all things in the cosmos are, end quote, made, end quote, and quick by spirit, that this unitary spirit, quintessence or one thing, is as it were an engine or machine, i.e. an organon, subject to the will of God and therefore in man, to man's will. Moreover, the same spirit is the common, thus in X. 6. 3. Sensible, the spirit is that which doth discern appearances. It is distributed into sensory. 2. 81f. End quote. The various sense-organs. Ampersand QUOT. A portion of it becomes, end quote, means of which was e, end quote, and suffer therest of the senses. Delight in blood and moist seed, end quote, adding that, end quote, means by spiritual sight, end quote, or end quote, spirit by of blood and out of the hematic fluids is the procreation of, end quote, flesh, but delight is not nourishment. As Goethe said, end quote, blood is a and it is worth in this connection that the bond of blood relationship plays the chief role both in primitive ancestor worship and also in most modern spirit communications. Quite peculiar fluid, end quote, noting. 54. The subtle body, if this spirit, in the case of man, end quote, is led upwards by the understanding, end quote, then it discerns sensibles, that is, apparently, what are called realities, end quote. But if it is objective not, it only maketh pictures for itself, end quote, that is given over to fantasy or imagination, phantasia or to fantasticon. We learn, however, from the myth of the imprisonment of the souls in fleshly bodies as a punishment, that when thus incarnate they lose the direct vision they previously enjoyed, and their sense becomes dim. They can no longer see heaven and their starry brethren in their true forms. They complain that their bodies are now, end quote, and their watery spheres, end quote, organs of vision, end quote, windows not, end quote, k. 21 eyes, k. 3. All of this may be taken to reflect the Platonized dogmas of syncretic mystical Alexandrian psychology or psychopyhysiology, tinged with Egyptian and perhaps Persian, that is Chaldeo-Magian, notions. The later Platonic school proper boasted that it continued the direct tradition of one Orpheus, Pythagoras and Plato. But what one see my Orpheute, London, 1896. 109. The spirit body 66, we may call revived or Pythagorean or Pietism spells already for the latest scholarship, a decided Oriental, that is probably Babylonian Persian, influence. And this or Pietism strongly influenced Plato, also in his myths. Omitting earlier Pietism, however, is there anything from the later period that may help us in our present inquiry? If the graphic vision of the after-death state, an arresting rumor of the hither hereafter, handed on or redacted by Plutarch at the end of the first century, in his treatise on the divine one delay of justice, and thought by some to underlie the general idea of Dante's Inferno and perhaps Purgatorio, can be held to be based on the doctrines of Neopythagorean Orphic mystagogy, they have something to or purpose. In any case, the eclectic Plutarch, though difficult to label, has been classed by some as a Platonist or even as a Neoplatonist, and therefore may legitimately come into our purview. 1. De Sera Numinis Vindicta for a translation and commentary C10 Vision of Aretius, 1907, in the series Echoes from the Gnosis, London. 56. The subtle body, though the word spirit is nowhere mentioned, the idea is there, for the deceased are said to be surrounded with a, end quote, flame-like bubble or envelope. These surrounds are described according to their purity or impurity as follows, even color. Others again were quite mottled. Extraordinary sights, dappled with livid spots like adders, and others had, end quote, faint scratches. The discolorations in the passions that give rise to them are described, and it is, end quote, some were like the full moon purest light, emitting one smooth, continuous and, XXII, p. 564d, that, end quote, it is an earth life that the vice of the soul, being acted upon by the passions and reacting upon the spirit body, produces these discolorations, while the purifications and corrections here, SC, in the after-death state, have for their object the removal of these blemishes, so that the soul, the spirit rather, may become entirely ray-like, augoids, and of uniform color, end quote, p. 565c. We will now turn to the opinions of the later Platonists proper, and especially to explain. Spirit Body 57, the views of Plotinus, and of his disciple, editor and assiduous commentator, Porphyry, who are generally held to be the most sober philosophers of the school, though indeed of late their successors also are being recognized as possessed of an excellent philosophical equipment. And yet, strangely enough, neither of them was a Greek, for Plotinus was in all probability an Egyptian and Porphyry unquestionably a Syrian. Though the school technically ends with Damasus, also a Syrian, the last occupant of the Platonic Cathedra, who retired to the court of the Persian king Chosroes, when the Christian emperor Justinian closed the pagan schools of philosophy in 529, its influence still survived. For John Philoponus, the last of the Alexandrian philosophers, whom we shall bring into court later on, is saturated with its views. Philoponus flourished at Alexandria in the first half of the 5th century, and is renowned for his learning and his elaborate commentaries on the works of Plato and Aristotle, in the now generally discredited 58. The subtle body story of the burning of the Alexandrian library by Amru, the general of Omar. It is said that it was to Johannes the Laborious that the familiar question about the Quran and the contents of the world-famed library was one put. Plotinus holds that all souls must be separable from bodies, with the sole exception of the universal soul from the universal body, for all bodies are in flux and perishable, except the one body of all, in its totality, which is eternal. What then in respect of souls, he asks, via 4:16, is the meaning of the popular phrase going Hades? To Hades or in being one its waste Cambridge Platonist Dean Cudworth, in his True Intellectual System of Bly Univert, first said, 1678, who first in later years drew sympathetic attention to the theory of spirituous and celestial bodies according to these philosophers, and won the commendation of the learned world for his exposition. In 1733, however, J.L. Mosheim severely criticized Cudworth's exposition, C.J. Harrison's translation of M.S. Latin notes, in the 1845 London edition of C.S. famous work, 3, 299ff. M. is never weary of inveighing against what he calls the end quote, insane imaginings end quote, generally obtained in academic circles up to the present day, of the end quote, junior Platonists, end quote, whom he has end quote, stigmatizes superstitious, trifling, credulous and fanatical end quote, p. 307n. Chiefly because they worked what we now call primitive culture notions into their all-embracing system. But can any true philosophy of human experience omit what is so elemental and fundamental? This bad habit set by Mosheim has. The spirit body 59, let Hades be taken to mean the invisible. It is not the soul that goes anywhere, for it itself is not moved, but is rather the cause or principle of movement. But just as we say the soul is there, in that place where the body is, so when it is separated from the physical body, but has still attached to it the subtle image, it may be said to go to, or be in, what he calls the asterisk inferior, where the place, spirit is. Even in the case of a soul set free by philosophy from a separate body or embodiment of any kind, and so abiding in purity in the intelligible state, or spiritual world proper in the highest sense of the term, the image still persists for a certain time in Hades. This is an ancient notion concerning the heroes, or demonic souls, Plotinus thinks in quote, I. 12. For Homer she, odd, 602-5, appears. 1. To admit this doctrine in the case of Hercules, speaking of his image as being in Hades, while he himself is among the gods. Ampersand, UUOT, the image, or eidolon, is intimately conimpure. 60. The subtle body connected with the irrational soul, which is poetically said to be the shadow cast by the shining of the rational soul on the body. I. 1. 2. The irrational soul is also said to be the image of the rational plunged into the obscurity of sensible life. IV. 3. 27. Elsewhere. 2. 2. 2. Speaking of a certain sphere-like or spherical psychical element, Plotinus avers that, whereas the proper movement of life is circular, as is most clearly seen in the heavenly bodies, the movement of our physical bodies is rectilinear, but there is also a circular or sphere-like body in us. It has, however, become terrestrial or obscure, and is no longer light as in the case of heavenly bodies. The nature of the movement of the spirit is probably of this kind. The spirit is the element that moves circle-wise in us. It is originally, as it were, an airy or igneous body, the inner clothing or attachment of the soul before it descends into a terrestrial body. IV. 3. 9. 15. This view of the meaning of going to THE spirit body 61 Hades, or being in Hades, Porphyry also expounds in his summary of Plotinian 1 doctrine. Thus he tells us that in the same way as being on earth is for the soul, not its moving about on earth, as physical bodies do, but having control of a body that moves about on earth, so also being in Hades for the soul is when it has attached to it the management of an image or spirit which has its existence in space, or whose nature it is to be in a place. This image, in the case of the unpurified, I suffer dark or cloud out in nature. Accordingly, if Hades is the underworld, and therefore an obscure state of existence compared with the celestial spheres, the soul may be said to go there so long as it has such a darkened image attached to it. By being in Hades is then meant that the soul is in the state of its invisible and darkened nature. It is owing to the propensity of the asterisk, physis, partial reason of the soul towards such one scent, ad intelligere religi du sens, 6, p. 18f, ed. Leipzig, 1907, p. is commenting on. IV. 3. 9. 62. The subtle body and such a body, owing to its habit or its habitual relationship to a certain body on earth, that a certain form or type of fantasy or imaging is impressed upon the spirit after death, the spirit itself having no special one form. But what is the meaning of going beneath to porphyry assumes that the impure spirit may be so heavy, or watery, as he calls it, that it can be said to go to the underworld. But he reiterates that the essence or life or consciousness of the soul itself cannot be said to change place or be in a place, but the earth, world, one com, inatus, p. 130, 31 Schrader copy, Porply, ed. The, end quote. For to souls, to the poet, Homer images of according their experiences above, on earth, continue to appear as phantasms, p. spirit, end quote. The shapes many forms, end quote. Adgor, v. 1, to Abstin, which characterize this below as well, end quote. 168, 7, ed. Na oak are molded in, end quote. Damuyus make the forms of the phantasms appear on the airy spirit, whether the spirit be their own or that of someone else. Ampersand quot, the daemons, or let us say spirits in th spiritistic sense, it should be noted, may be good or bad. They are not necessarily bad like the demons of the Christians. Too, it should be remembered that according to Orphic notions, which broke away from the primitive Babylonian, Semitic and Egyptian conceptions of Sheol and Arnenti, the subterranean proper was believed to be the lower state of Tartarus. The higher regions of Hades were supposed to extend from the earth's surface to the moon. This improvement was owing to the influence of the doctrines of astral or sidereal religion. J. The spirit body 63 only that it contracts the habits of bodies whose nature is to change place and occupy space. For as is the disposition of the soul, so does it obtain a body conditioned in rank and properties. Just as the soul can be kept 011 earth only by means of the earthy shell, so can it be kept in Hades only by its attachment to the image or moist spirit. According to ancient physics, the downward elements are the earthy and moist, the moist being supposed originally to extend below the earth, and the upward, the airy and fiery. The soul has thus that humid or moist element attached to it as long as it wills to associate with, or has its attention fixed on, things in generation. The idea that the moist principle was that which conditioned all genesis, generation, or birth and death, that it, so to say, constituted the ocean of animal and plant life, the state of perpetual flux, or ever becoming, was a general dogma of the school. Indeed, it seems to have been a leading notion of ancient mystic lore in general. 64. The subtle body. Thus we find elsewhere one porphyry explain, in the Egyptian symbolism of the boats or barks of the daemons as being intended to represent not solid bodies, but the vehicles, end quote, sail on the moist ampersand quot. This applied to all grades, from the soul of the sun god to all souls that descend into Genesis. And with regard to the latter sites, the Heraclitus logoi in which they porphyry souls to become moist is delight or death, end quote. Delight consisting in their falling into, end quote. We live their soul's death, and the life or death, ampersand quot, generation, and the two elsewhere in the same treatise. 3. Porphyry tells us that, according to the Stoics, souls who love the body attract a moist spirit to them, and condense it like a cloud, for the moist being condensed in air constitutes a cloud, that when the spirit and souls is one to end. Nymph X, where he cites as his authority Numenius, the Alexandrian Pythagorean Platonic philosopher and student of what we should now call comparative religion, who flourished in the middle of the 2nd century. A copy. Deals, 2nd ed. Berlin, 1906, FR 77. Copy. FR 36, end quote. For souls it is death to become water, end quote. And FR 62, end quote. Immortal mortals, mortal immortals, the one living the death and dying the life of the other. Ampersand quot, sj and nymph she, P. 64, ed. Not oak. End quote. 4. THE spirit body 66 condensed by a superabundance of the moist element, they become visible. Of such are the apparitions of images of the deceased that are occasionally met with, the spirit being further more colored and shaped by fantasy, that is the imagination. The rest of the Neoplatonic philosophers held more or less the same general views on the nature of the spirit body in its unpurified state. There was, however, a great difference of opinion as to whether or not the soul could be entirely separated from this body. Some held that it could, others contended that it was only its impurities that could be cast off, as we shall see when we come to treat of what they called the luciform or radiant vehicle. That there were many different views among the philosophical schools in general, not only on the more transcendental relationships of the soul, but also on the inferior connection between soul and body, may be one seen from Philoponus 9:35f. 10:4-3. The references are to Ed. M. Hayduck, Berlin, 1897, com. In Arid, R.C. Akkad. lit.beg.ber.volume.xv. The Rice, unfortunately, no English translation. Philoponian Ritatili d'Anima, e. 66. The subtle body, whose instructive commentary on Aristotle's famous treatise on the soul we may now turn. Philoponus was in an excellent position to review the whole ground. Moreover, he sought to reconcile, or make of, Plato and Aristotle. He contends, 10:4f, that the true doctrine of these two great masters is, 12:15, that every soul is incorporeal, that whereas the rational soul alone is separable from every body, and on this account is not subject to death, the irrational is separable from the physical body, but inseparable from the spirit, that is, the spirituous body would persist for ascertain to me after its departure from the gross body. As to the vegetative soul, it has its existence in the physical body only, and perishes together with it. There is no spirit body in plants, 17:8f. This last point is straightly contradicted by the long tradition of alchemy, which bestows spirits not only on plants, but also on metals. Philoponus later on admits a somewhat of vegetative life in the animal spirit body. Symphony. THE spirit body 67. The irrational soul persists after death. L. Ponderans of Earth, 17:20. The spirit body is the medium of existence in Hades, and also provides a basis for the phantasms of the deceased. As to the chastisements in Hades, they cannot really purify the soul, for the soul being self-moved must purify itself of its own free will, and must, therefore, return to Earth for this purpose. The chastisements are simply for the purpose of turning it to itself, causing it to repent, or wean itself from sympathy with the things of generation, 17:2518-25. As to the inferior means of purification and the rationale of phantasms of the deceased, Philoponus has the following, end quote. Now that the also they say spirit body has somewhat of the vegetative life, for it is its vehicle or substrate, the having spirituous body, which is composed of the four elements, but has in it a preponderance of air, just as the earthy body has a pre-1924ff. One, this view differs somewhat from that of the school, cp. 51 above. Trismegistic. 68. The subtle body also is nourished, not however in the same way as this gross body, but by means of vapors, not by parts, i.e. by separate organs, but the whole of it through the whole, as one organism, so to say, just like a sponge. And so those who are in earnest favor a lighter and drier diet, to prevent its becoming dense, end quote. Moreover, they say there are certain means of purification. As this gross body is cleansed with water, so is that spiritualist body by purifications of vapors, for it is nourished with certain vapors and cleansed one in quote. They say it is not provided with organs, but the whole of it, through the whole of it, is active as a sensory and lays hold of sensible objects, end quote. Wherefore also Aristotle in his says, Metaphysics, p. 455, 20, that properly senses one, and the true sensory one, by sensory meaning the spirit, in which the sense power as a whole, through the whole one the same reason, is given for the use of the famous Egyptian incensed Tufi by Plutarch, D.I. 0, x. 6, 2, with others, where aha fits and quote, speaks connate with the fanning up, the fire off ye the spirit body. Ampersand QUOT. THE spirit body 69, sensory, lays hold of the manifold objects of sense. Ampersand QUOT. But if it have no organs, how can it be said to account for phantasms which apparently have organs, and manifest sometimes in the forms of men and sometimes in other animal forms? In the first place, when made dense with it isn't, quote, molded into heavy diet, readily the shape of its surrounding body, just as happens with ice, which takes the shape of the vessels in which it is formed. Ampersand QUOT, but this does not account for its taking different forms. To this end, quote, it is, they say, probable that, when the soul desires to manifest, it shapes itself, that is, the spirit BODJ, setting its own imagination in movement, or even that it is probable with the help of demonic cooperation that it appears and again becomes condensed and rarefied, end quote. A theory that may not be without interest to modern spiritists and those familiar with the phenomena of materializing seances, invisible, being for here demonic cooperation might easily render spirit help. Asterisk. 70. The subtle body it is, moreover, laid down as a general dogma that the power of sensation resides not in the physical body, but in the spirit. 161. 4. It is, for instance, not the ear, nor even the membrane or drum of the ear, one that is the hearing sensory, but the spirit. 353. 32. In brief, it is the spirit body that is the unitary or common sense organ. 433, 34. This, Philoponus says, is the doctrine of both Aristotle and the Platonici. Thus he tells us, 488, 25, that, according to Aristotle, for in this the sense has first of all its being, end quote. The first in which is the sensory, sensing power, is that the spirit, the substrate of the irrational soul, end quote. Ears and nostrils are eyes, sense organs only. They do not come first, for the feeling soul is not in them. They are the means whereby sensible experience is referred to the spirit. Ampersand QUOT. And again, 239, 3, according to Aristotle, 1 copy, 364, 15, and for the visual spirit, 161, 25, 336, 17, 20, 33, 37, 337, 6, 14 ff. It should be remembered that ancient physiology was apparently totally ignorant of the nervous system. The problem for us today is removed a stage. It is, however, fundamentally the name problem. THE spirit body 71 of sensation are established, end quote. The powers in the spirit, for the whole, through the whole of it, both sees and hears and is active the aintherest of the senses. And thus all the senses are in it, just as in plants are the Platonists also declare, he tells us the one, the vegetative powers, spirit itself is not organized. Ampersand QUOT. That end quote. The of sensibles apprehension 597, 23. Does not at all take place through physical organs, inasmuch as both in us, i.e. in the case of men, the common sense, residing in a single spirit, perceives the objects of the five senses, and the irrational soul, in the case of animals, by means of a single spirit apprehends all sensibles. Q-U-O-T. And so in general Philoponus sums up the doctrine as follows, 481, 19 ff. End quote. The common sense, which in itself is incorporeal, functions in the body, which is its ground. This ground is the spiritualist, thus the various orders of sensible body. Phenomena, another, occur in the spiritualist body. Now 131, end quote. In the spirit, however, the psychic copy, 201, powers are disposed, as are the vegetative in trees, the lowell of them being spread throughout the whole spirit. Q-U-O-T, though different from one. 72, the subtle body in one portion, now in another of it. Subsequently the power itself, i.e. the common sense, discriminates the sensible experiences in the spirit, and so we keep the reason free from sense, and do not say that different forms occur in it which has no parts, sc. the rational soul, but that they occur in the greatest body, that is the spirituous, in different portions of it. Q-U-O-T. The spirit body being thus regarded as the true sensory, it was also thought to be the medium for what are now called thought transference and voices also, both bad and good. And so, we find Psellus, in his famous treatise on the daemons, here meaning non-human as well as human discarnate entities, p. 94, p. 72, suggesting that the way the lower orders of these invisibles insinuate their temptations into men's souls is by immediately affecting the fantastic spirit or imaginal essence. End quote. When a man addresses another from a distance, he has to speak more loudly, but if he be close, he can whisper into his ear. End quote. It were for him to possible if, moreover, telepathy, for asterisk inner. The spirit body 78 come into close contact with the spirit of his soul, he would need no uttered speech, but all he wanted to say would reach the hearer by a soundless way. End quote. That this is also the what they say way souls on leaving the body. For they, too, communicate with one another without sound. Q-U-O-T. It need hardly be pointed out that this more immediate communication of mind with mind is a common persuasion. From the days of Swedenborg to the present, in all the modern rumors of the hither hereafter, not only delirium, Philoponus tells us, 164, but also the frequent derangement and dulling of the understanding when a man is in possession of his normal senses, are supposed to be due to changes in the spirit, when, according to Aristotle, 418, 24, end quote, either a spiritualist body undergoes certain breakdown or, by being out of symmetry, troubles and hampers the understanding. Q-U-O-T. So also with regard to memory, Philoponus explains, 158, 7, that, though the memory, 74, the subtle body movement may be said to start from the end quote. We do not mean that the soul remembers of itself by itself, but that, just as in the case of the senses, we say that the movement starting from the sensible objects reaches that in which the discriminating and the spirit are. Also in the case of memory, we say that it is from the spirit in which the soul is vehicled, that the start of the memory movement takes place. Q-U-O-T. That academic psychology will deign seriously to consider the hypothesis of the spirit body in any shape or form is not, of course, the vastly greater knowledge of physiology and biology which we now possess must very considerably change the ancient doctrine in many respects, but the main notion in its simplest form has so well fitted in with the unsophisticated experience of mankind for so many ages, that it may still be found in some respects to deserve the scrutiny of unprejudiced investigation. Soul, seen as perceptive power, resides, namely, yet very probable. Psychical research, however, appears with every day to be more and more driven in this direction. The radiant body. Though the term asterisk augades has been popularized by Bull or Litton, The majority of readers of the novelist know no more about the mystical doctrine concerning it than they may have gleaned from the somewhat confused soliloquy of Zanoni. End quote. Soul of the divine, luminous Augites, why descendest thou from thy sphere with from the eternal, star like and passionless rain? Shrinkest thou back to how long, too austerely taught that companionship with the things that die brings with it but sorrow in its sweetness? Hast thou dwelt content with the majestic solitude M1? To this the author, in the 1853 edition, appended a note containing a paragraph 1 Zanoni, B.K. 2. Chapter 4, First Ed, 1845. Zanoni was developed from a crude and floridly romantic sketch called Zichi, a serial contributed to the Monthly Chronicle, in 1838. The soliloquy is not found in Zichi. Chapter IV, 75. The Mists, The Dark Sarcophagus. 76. The Subtle Body in Greek, to which the reference and of which the translation are both erroneous. The passage is from Marcus Aurelius, G. 12, and runs as follows, end quote. The of the soul is radiant one, when it is neither extended to any object, nor is contracted inwards, to nor is convoluted, nor collapses. But when sphere, augites, it is made to shine with whereby it sees the truth of all things, and the truth in itself. &QUOT. Let us then see whether, with a modicum of industry, a little more light may be thrown on the subject. In classical Greek, augites is an adjective meaning possessive, a form of augi, that is, of a form of splendor, hence brilliant, shining, radiant, ray-like, luciform, glorious, etc. 1. This is a questionable reading, though it may have some probability from the concluding paragraph of the context. The latest text read autoides, that is, like itself, uniform, self-formed. See the imp, m and com, libri xxii, reg, I stitch, Leipzig, 1903, p. 147. To reading o tripose u for c r tempt q. This gives the idea of coil, spiral or convolution, of ovoid as compared with perfect sphere, brightness, brilliance, radiance, that light. The radiant body. 77. So much for the dictionary. But what of the augites as the radiant body, or glorious vehicle or vesture of the soul? We have already discussed at some length the ideas of the later Platonists, and of their immediate predecessors and successors, on the nature of the spiritualist vehicle, or spirit body, or spirit, six neioma or tisma numericon, and may therefore proceed, without further introduction, to treat of that prime essence or substance of all bodies, and of all embodiment, to which these philosophers most commonly give the name augites. The root notion was most probably taken over into Greek philosophy from Orpiachism, that is to say, presumably from the influence of the old Oriental doctrines of Asia Minor or Heather Asia on Hellenic thought. Now the line of descent for their theology was set by the Platonoi themselves from Orpheus to Pythagoras and Plato. Let us then, first, turn to the earliest and latest of the school of the Academy, to Plato himself and to Damasus and Hermistic. 78. The subtle body, what they have to say about this sensible vehicle of purity and truth. In that magnificent passage of the Phaedrus, 250c, in which he speaks of the vision of heavenly beauty, Plato dwells on the philosophic memory or reminiscence of that state when the souls of men had not yet fallen into generation, and continues, end quote, there was a time when could they behold beauty in all its brilliance, when, together with the rest of the blessed company, we philosophers in the train of Zeus, and other ranks of souls in the train of some other of the gods, they both beheld the beatific spectacle and divine vision, and were initiated into that mystery, which truly may be called the holiest of all, in which we joyed in mystic ecstasy, end quote. For then we were ourselves still in the state of holiness, and unconscious of the evils that away I do into meadow comb, not only being made mystically conscious of one to the divine forms in wholeness, yet in indicating the lower grade of the mises with eyes shut or veiled, to blinata sc the ideas. The radiant body 79 singleness, void of all motion yet filled, full one and not yet sunk into this tomb, Sema, which now we bear about with us and call it body, Soma, bound fast to it, like oyster to its shell. Ampersand QUOT, to pass from the grandiose intuition of the founder of the school to the last occupant of the cathedra of the academy, Damasius, who was driven from the chair in 529 by Justinian. In his commentary on the Parmenides of Plato, Damasus writes of the radiant vehicle as follows, throughout its depths, and lends it a divine strength, end quote. But in lower states, losing this, radi signifying the higher degree of the apoptia, with eyes open or unveiled. A Joannes translation, I, 456, misses almost every one of the technical points. Shall we say this is owing to his over-anxiety to modernize Plato for literary purposes of bliss, but also eye to eye beholding them in radiance, augi of purity. 414, end quote, for we were then pure ourselves, end quote, in our radiant heaven. Indeed, Augustoides' portion is fulfilled with heavenly radiance, augi of glory that streams. 80, the subtle body ends, it is dirtied, as it were, and becomes darker and darker and more material, end quote. Heedless it wards the earth, yet in its essence is it still the same in number, i.e. unity, grows, end quote. So also with our soul strives upwards unto mind and God, then is its essence, sc, the augoides, fulfilled with mystic light divine, of which it previously, sc, in incarnation, was not one possessed, else had it always been divine. Ampersand QUOT. Damasius also says elsewhere too that Isidorus, who was the friend of Proclus and Marinus, and husband of Hypatia, and who occupied the cathedra of the school for a brief period, had stated, on the authority of some other philosopher, whom we can no longer identify owing to the loss of the context, that, end quote, the soul has a certain radiant vehicle, one rule, see, a Damasky success or is dubitatio onis t solutions asterisk de primit principiet in Platonis Parmenidum, Paris, 1889, 270. There is a French translation by A. J. Ned, Paris, 1908, 3 volumes, copy, 3, 147. 9 in his lift of Isidorus, which is lost. We owe the quotation to the lexicon of Suclus, ed. Bernhardi, Holly, 1853, 1. 850 f. Ed. Becker, Berlin, 1854, p. 194, and sinks down to itself, wouldn't it? Figuratively one, for instance, in the Child's Oracles, end quote. The poem, The Radiant Body 81-1, Ogoside Zooklygma, as it is called, starlight, astral ideas, and eternal. And this vehicle is securely shut away in this gross body, according to some within the head, and according to others within the right shoulder, a statement which no one else seems to have made. Ampersand QUOT. It is doubtful whether the last clause is due to Damasus or to Suidas. In any case, it refers solely to the queer statement about the right shoulder. Perhaps it is then hardly worthwhile in this connection to remind ourselves of a too certain mystic silver cord, or psychical, which is asterisk seen and attachment, variously spoken of. This is supposed by a few to start from between the shoulder blades. It is also imagined to unroll itself as it were from a point or center, and contract itself again into a point, when as subtle vehicle, leptonoglima of the soul, end quote, quoted by Hierocles in his commentary on the golden verse of Pythagoras, is v. 67-69. 1. The reference to a silver cord will indubitably remind the reader of the phrase in the magnificent but exceedingly puzzling, concluding outburst of Kahalef Ekla Zi 6. But the treatment of the whole passage, Zi 1-8, would be too long a story for this occasion. F. 82 The subtle vehicle leaves and returns to the body in certain mystic experiences. The phenomenon is very variously described, and the cord has numerous points of attachment according to others. The Ogalides was, however, as we see, thought more usually to be centered, as it were a light spark, in the head, that is, its only point of contact with the physical body was a maginetto behind the head, where yast spiritualist body, as we have seen in our last essay, was thought of as pervading the whole gross body and surrounding it. We may now turn to two passages of a more detailed nature, taken from the works of Porphyry, F305 AD, and of Proclus, F485 AD, in his Sententics, which are practically a summary of Platinian doctrine. Speaking of the soul, Porphyry tells us that, end quote, when it is in a condition, it has purer cognate with it the body that is nigh to the immaterial state, viz. The ethereal aethcrian body, end quote. But when it from reason proceeds, logos, into the projection of imagination, plien, the radiant body, 83 tasha, it has cognate with it the sun-like, helioides, body, end quote. When further it becomes womanish and grows in passion for form, it has the moon-like, selenoix, body, present with it. Amorphous state composite of moist exhalations, complete ignorance of reality, obscura, end quote. And when it falls into bodies, which it does whenever it gets into an, finally, shin and childishness supervene for it, end quote. When, however, it tries to separate itself from this nature, it becomes a dry radiance, augy, shadowless and cloudless, end quote. For moisture forms cloud in one air, while dryness changes vapor into dry radiance, augy.ampersand quot, asterisk. With this we may compare the following passage from Proclus' commentary on the Timaeus of Plato, says both mind and reason, noils and logos, end quote. Man is a little world, microcosmos. For, just like the universe, to pan, he posed and moisture in air being densified produces cloud. Ampersand quot. J1 Imp. P. 64. 16 copy. Orf. Na oak. End quote. For Porphyry, sententis ad intelligibilia ducts. 6. P. 14 F. Ed. Mamert, Leipzig. 1907. 84 The subtle body bought the divine immortality. He's also divided up according to the universe, end quote. It is for this reason, you know, that some are accustomed to say that his mystic principle, Tunaron, corresponds with the nature of the fixed stars, end quote. His reason corresponds in its contemplative aspect with Saturn, and in its social aspect with Jupiter, end quote. As to his irrational part, the positional nature corresponds with Mars, the eloquent with Mercury, the appetitive with Venus, the sensitive with Sol, and the vegetative with Luna, end quote. Moreover, the radiant vehicle, Ogalides Oglima, corresponds with heaven, and this mortal frame with the sublunary M1 region. In these two passages we have two different schemes of ordering the psychical embodiment and activities of man, the lesser world, in correspondence with the astral components of the greater world. Porphyry follows the ancient ordering of one Procle, Commentarius and Plotones Timcum, 384, asterisk, B. P. Ed. Schneider, Radis Avis, 1847, p. 848. The radiant body, 85 Old Babylonian tradition, where the sun and moon succeed to the pure ethereal space and precede the planets. Proclus uses the language of the later Neo-Babylonian astrologers, and that too in a Hellenized or philosophized form. Now, the general tenor of the most recent research justifies us in ascribing the introduction of the idea of the Ogoites into Greek areopagio philosophy to ancient Orphic mystagogy blended with Pythagoreanism. Indeed, as is well known, and as we have said before, the Platonici themselves in very claimed that the sources of their theology went back through Plato and Pythagoras to Orpheus himself. It is, therefore, of interest to see what hierarchals the Neoplatonic philosopher of Alexandria, who flourished in the middle of the 5th century, has to tell us of this radiant body in his commentary on the Golden Verses, which contained the so-called symbols of the Pythagorean discipline. These symbols are enigmatic sayings or allegorical precepts envisaging moral truths. They are technically known as exteriorization. 86. The subtle body, or things heard. The most recent opinion, that of Professor Barouet, will have it at most off the mere tab use of a thoroughly primitive one type. Hierarchals tells us practically that the object of the whole of the purificatory degrees of this far-famed method of discipline was nothing else than the restoration of this quintessential embodiment to its original state. End quote. The end of the method of the Pythagoreans was that they should become furnished with wings to soar to the reception of the divine blessings, in order that, when the day of death comes, the athletes in the games of philosophy, i.e. the love of wisdom, leaving their mortal body on earth, and stripping off its nature, sc. the spiritualist be unencumbered for the to my body, heavenly journey. Ampersand QUOT, and so also, commenting, in XXVI, on verses 67-69, he tells us, end quote, from these Pythagoras published volume of Hastings' Encyclopedia of Religion and Ethics, 1 C. Art. Pythagoreanism, in the last ED. Needham, Cambridge, 1709, p. 227, verses, arid whoever of us is not. The radiant body 87 and attentive to the Pythagorean counsels, should learn that, together with the discipline, schisis, of virtue and the recovery of truth, he shall also be diligent in the purification of his radiant, Ogoites, body, which the Chaldean oracles also call the subtle vehicle of the soul. Ampersand QUOT, and this he repeats a little later as follows, end quote, just it is to adorn as, then, necessary, cosmesei, the soul with science, esteem, and virtue, so that it may be able to company with those who are eternally wise and virtuous, so also must we make our radiant communion with the ethereal bodies. Ampersand QUOT. 1 From the above passages, we may be permitted to deduce that the chief grades of this spiritual discipline were purity, virtue, and truth. We may now conclude as part of our essay by some apposite quotations from Ogoites, body, pure, gross matter, in order that it may support 1 to sc. the stars and bodies of the gods, Needham, p. 222, Mulak, p. 481b, Needham, p. 214, Mulak, Paris, 1860, p. 478b, and free from. 88. The subtle body Philoponus, who lived at Alexandria in the first half of the 5th century, and who was, as we saw in our last sketch, in a very favorable position to sum up the doctrines of the Platonic school. The chief passage of Philoponus on the Ogoites runs as follows, end quote. There this is, moreover, beyond, spiritus body, another kind of body, that is forever attached to, the soul, of a celestial, and for this reason everlasting, which they call radiant, Ogoites, or star-like, astralides, end quote. For as, the soul is a being of the cosmic order, it is absolutely necessary that it should have an estate or portion of the cosmos in which to keep house, end quote. And nature, if it is in a state of, the soul, perpetual motion, and it is necessary that it should be forever in activity, it needs must be that it should ever have attached to it some body or other which it keeps eternally alive, end quote. For these forever keeps its radiant, Ogoites, body, which is of an one everlasting nature. Ampersand quot reasons, therefore, they say it Philoponian Aristotelist anima. Ed. Have Gluck, Berlin, 1897, 1826 FF. The ADINT body 89, speaking of this heavenly body from the macrocosmic, tells us that, according to the Platonici, end quote, the matter of celestial bodies, end quote, it is to show that necessary standpoint, Philoponus is not if but, end quote, there is another the four kind of body, the fifth, end quote, element, or quint one essence, and its form, eidos, is spherical. Afterwards, in treating of it from the microcosmic point of view, he writes, elements, further, the rational soul has the essence, or substance, usia, of every body attached to it, while the other souls have their existence in a certain order of body, viz., the irrational soul in the spirit, or spiritualis body. Body, end quote, and the vegetative in this, gross, 15, 19. Finally, in commenting on Aristotle's Dan, 2, 7, Philoponus tells us that, according to Aristotle, 76, 56, 3, copy, 88, 12, 188, 6, 21, 22, odd also 450, 29, where it is called the ethereal, and the four others, the end quote, the sublime everlasting, and body, partakes of transparency, and he calls it the outflow, clima, of the spheres, for all one single bodies. 90, the subtle body, one of them, are transparent, end quote, 324, 5, it pertains to the crystalline. Though the dogma of the inseparability of the soul from its essential substance or vehicle, the Augolides, was the general belief of the Platonic school, for without to the latter, as they contended, the soul could not continue in activity or actuality. There was also a purely absolutist doctrine of complete separability, which Aristotle tried to saddle on the master himself, as a deduction from a statement in the Timaeus. This is set forth by Philoponus as follows. End quote. Now in Plato's view, it is better for the soul to be without body of any kind. Life in body is full of toil for it. End quote. He from their body, whereas the universal moreover, that the cosmos will never be dissolved, and so the soul of the universe will be in a less fortunate state then, and not on inequality with our souls, inasmuch as Luaij will at some time be free believed notion. Some think that the name Alihyrui is derived from Kaima, the Al being, of course, the Arabic definite article. Alchemy first reappeared in the West through Latin translations from the Arabic versions of Greek originals. To see the first quotation from p. 18, 26 f. above. 1. This is the astral light body. 4. Soul, the radiant body. 91. Soul has to be forever inwoven with the universal body. End quote. At rate Aristotle draws this any finely conclusion, if really, as the Detruzes seems to say, the essence of the world, soul is inwoven with the world body. End quote. But even as the, on contrary, human soul, when it gains the mastery over the physical body, has this body following it, and does not itself follow the motions of the body, so, the fortiori, when the celestial body of the universe is free from all mortal disturbance and is moved solely by the will of the world, no disturbance results to the soul from it. End quote. And this is also the case with our own soul and its radiant Augolides body, 137, 27, if. The rest of this quest will be devoted to the consideration of what Sinsius has to tell us about the Augolides. Sinsius, 365, 430. AD, was a Neoplatonist and for many years a correspondent of Hypatius. Indeed, he sent his treatise on visions, from which the following 92 the subtle body quotations are taken to the philosopher for her approval. This treatise was written about 404 AD. He subsequently, about 23 years after, held a bishopric for some 3 years before his death. As what Signs Use has to tell us is that before Signs Use became a Christian, most detailed statement on the subject known to me, I venture to append a careful and full translation which may be all the more acceptable as there exists no English version. End quote. 7.1.135 D. If to see God with one's eyes, insensible nature is a felicitous experience, the comprehension of Him by means of imagination, fantasia pertains to a higher order of intuition. 1. The version with which I was when I only acquainted made the following translation, in 1910, A was the utterly valueless rendering, or rather paraphrase, of H. Drouin, Paris, 1878, which consistently misses every characteristic point. I was then under the impression that nothing in the way of a rendering existed in English, but subsequently came across W.S. Crawford's condensed summary, pages 473ff. In his instructive volume Signs Use the Helen, London, 1901. It is, however, in no way a translation and a very imperfect guide as a summary. The text used is I.G. Krabinger's edition of the Homilies and Fragments, Landshut, 1850, pages 323ff. The Radiant Body 93 end quote. Fort is of his D. Power imagination, 1. Sense of all differentiated senses, seeing that the spirit pneuma, whereby the imagination is brought into play, is the most general sensory and the first body of the soul, place, and dominates the living creature, 136 A, as it were from a citadel, for rounded nature has built up the whole economy of the head, sense, as it were doorkeepers, who notify their mistress of the sense objects outside, whereby the outturned organs of sense have their doors knocked upon, end quote. It has its seat in the innermost, end quote. Now and hearing are not but organs of sense, servants of the common, end quote. Whereas she in all simple sense, for she hears with the whole of the spirit, sc, the common sensory, and sees with the whole of it is for the rest of the senses, end quote. She it is who distributes the insoci powers of sense among the various sense organs, and they each proceed from the animal, i.e. the spirit, and are, as it were, sight senses, portions of her is. 94. The subtle body kinds of radii, issuing from a center and centering into it, being all one in respect of their common root, but many in their procession. End quote. Accordingly sense, when proceeding through the projected organs, is of a most animal-like nature. Indeed it is not sense at all before it arrives at its source. The immediate sense is more divine and closer to the soul. End quote. And so let no one whose imaginative spirit, pliantasticonetima, is diseased, expect clear and unconfused visions. End quote. Now what its disease, both what is, by things it is made bleared and dense, and by what it is cleansed and purged and returns to its natural state, you must learn one from the mystic philosophy, whereby also, after it has been purified by perfecting rites, tell Eden, it becomes God-possessed. The shin can receive God, the incomings of sense must flee away out of it. End quote. But he who it keeps pure, by living life according to nature, has it ever in one sc. The Chaldean oracles, end quote, before, however, body of Imagina. The radiant body 95 readiness, to be the most extended common sensory, even in this life, end quote. Spirit dispositions of the soul, and is not unsympathetic in itself, to them, as is the shell-like envelope, sc. The gross body, 137a, end quote. The latter indeed has ever a mystic nature to the higher dispositions of the soul, whereas its primal and eternal vehicle is subtilized and secularized when the soul is made virtuous. But when it is made vicious, its vehicle becomes dense and earthy, end quote. For this is the border spirit, precisely land between unreason and reason, between body and the bodiless, It is the common frontier of both, and by its means things divine are joined with lowest things. End quote. Therefore it is difficult for its nature one so is sensible of the purified to be comprehended by philosophy alone. End quote. 8.137b. For it lays under contribution what suits it, from both of the extremes, as from neighbors, and images in one single nature things that are poles apart. 1.so. Philosophy is distinguished from mystic philosophy. And ago. 96. The subtle body, end quote. As to the extent of this imaginative essence, nature has poured it into many divisions of being. Indeed, it goes down even as low as irrational creatures, so as the better to extend itself. End quote. Moreover, the whole of the daemons are supplied with their substance by this mode of life, or animal. For during the whole of their existence, they are of the nature of images and take on the one appearances of happenings. End quote. As for man, he is conscious of many things by means of this essence, even when by itself, and of more when there is another, a daemon or spirit, with it. End quote. For orders of make, the daemon's thoughts always to have some mixture of imagination, except perchance a man in a flash establish a material contact with an idea. End quote. But the of transcending imagination is as difficult as it is blissful. End quote. For mind and wisdom, says Plato, one, this is a remarkable and highly suggestive statement, ere it might well be used as a working hypothesis by those engaged in modern psychical research genera of the radiant body. 97 filed 59 O, are beloved by him to whomsoever they come even in old age, meaning, by this, the power that transcends imagination. End quote. For the life that is forth is surely of the imagination, or of a mind that has recourse to imagination. End quote. 9. In 137d, case this any spirit, which the blessed ones call also a spiritual soul, becomes both a god, and a daemon capable of assuming any form, and an image, or shade, in which last the soul works out its corrections. End quote. For not the oracles are in only agreement about it, likening the manner of life of the soul in the after state of correction to the image happenings in dream, but also philosophy concludes that the first lives on ea.rdh are preparations for the second in the after state. End quote. It the habit of his, moreover, higher mind and souls which lightens the spirit, one the Hellenistic beam known as Chaldean oracles, the scolium of Nicephorus, and Gregorized Byzantine histories Libri, the 37th, Magn, Pat, G.R., Torn, C.X.L.I.X., Connell, 569, erroneously glosses it as the sacred writers among the Egyptians, referring to the initiated of the tradition preserved in pictured one psychic. 98. The subtle body, and wipes off the stains of the lower habit, end quote. 138.8. And so by natural impulses it either rises on high owing to its heat and one dryness asterisk winging, and this of course is Plato's of the soul. Moreover, we find that Heraclitus S. wise soul, dry radiance too comes to the same thing. Augie, precisely dense and moist, it sinks into the depths of earth by natural tendency, lurking there, nay, thrust down into the three subterranean state, end quote, or becoming, end quote, for this is suitable for region, very moist spirits, end quote. Life in this state is miserable and penal, yet it is possible even for such a spirit, when it has been purified by time and toil in other lives, to rise. For, becoming a thing of double life, it runs a double course, and companies partly with the lower, and partly with the higher, regions. End quote. It is this spirit which the first soul, when it descends, has loaned to it from the spheres, and going on board of it, as 123 Cedr, 246 D, 118 Swiss francs, deals, Berlin, 1906. Copy. PH 281C. End quote. Thereon ensues either to take the radiant body 99 on a boat, it comes into contact with the corporeal world. Struggle, it, the spirit, aloft with it, or it may be even no longer to continue with it. The latter, however, is a rare case. End quote. Nevertheless, it may be compelled to let it go, if it will not follow, for it is not lawful to be unfaithful when once the initiatory rites have been known. End quote. It would indeed be a sad disgrace for souls to return on high without repaying what does not belong to them, leaving behind in the surround of the EA.RDH instead of in the higher spheres what they have borrowed on their way down. End quote. Yet even this may happen in the case of one or two as a grace of perfect initiation, tell it, yea of God. End quote. But the natural state of affairs is that, when the soul is once engrafted into the spirit, they either pull together, or one pulls over or is pulled over by the other, whence it came. End quote. But in case any harm till the return of the soul to the state, they join together. 100 The subtle body, end quote. And so when the spirit is weighed down by vice, it drags down together with it that soul who allows it to be so weighed down. End quote. And this is the that the oracles give to the Gnostic seed in us, warning not down into naive which is ever spread the abyss, devoid of form, where is no light to see, wrapped in black gloom. End quote. See that thou the world of the dark rays, verge befouling, that joys in images idle, void one of all understanding. End quote. For how can an infatuate life void of all understanding be a good thing for the mind? Whereas for the image this lower region is suitable, owing to the composition of its spirit being then of a similar nature. For *2 like loves like. From their coupling, the two should become one. Then the mind as well would be doused in the delight of pleasure. End quote. And, indeed, this would be the most one using Grawl's text, p. 61, 3 p. My C. Tialcian Oracles, London, 1908-2, 86, end quote, 10, 138d. If, however, a Platonic proverb, cp.simp.195s,ly.214b,georg.51gb, end quote. And on this, both in this life, the radiant body 101 extreme of ills not to be conscious of the presence of evil. For this is the condition of those who no longer even try to rise. 139a, just like a hardened tumor, which gives no pain, nor reminds to seek a cure. End quote. And for this reason repentance one is any means. For he elevating metan kriya, who feels impatience with the circumstances in which he finds himself, devises means of escape. End quote. Now the chief in his thing purification they will. For then both deeds and words lend a helping hand. But one will is absent, the whole purificatory discipline of initiation is soulless, being lopped of its chief characteristic, account, and in the afterlife, accesses of suffering afford the greatest and best service to the orders of existence, introducing pain and purging the soul of infatuate joy. End quote. And what are called, so mistakenly, misfortunes contribute largely to breaking up the habit we have for things here. One by this, as we see in the sequel, the philosophers meant a change of will, the conversion of the whole man. 102 The subtle body, the divine providence is revealed to those possessed of mind by these very happenings, which cause people who are not possessed of mind to disbelieve in it, since it is not possible for the soul ever to turn its face away from matter if it does not come into collision with any evil in things here. End quote. Wherefore we should consider the successes that people talk so much about as a trap laid for souls by the overseers of things below. It, the sweet and dulling drink down here. End quote. Nay, end quote. And so I leave to others that there may be a draft of oblivion for souls on their departure from the physical body. End quote. It is rather when the soul enters into this life that an oblivion draft is given into its first life as a free worker. Instead of so working, it volunteers for slavery. End quote. That is to it had to a say, discharge certain service to the nature of the world, according to the laws imposed by destiny. End quote. For descending pretension. End quote. Bewitched though the radiant body 103 of its condition resembles that of free men who have hired themselves out by agreement for a time, who under the spell of some slave, when Jeff's beauty volunteer to stop, agreeing to serve the beloved object as master, but being matter, by gifts, end quote, and so due affections from the depth of the mind to the state of bodily concerns and external so seem in good sado seem to agree with matter, that it is fair, we, whenever we transfer our, end quote, but she matter s.c. nature, mistress, holds our agreement as a mystic secret bond, and even if we decide to be off as though free men, she claims we are fugitives, and tries to bring us back again, and has us seized as runaways, quoting her document against us, end quote. Is it that the soul has need of valid strength, yea, even of God to help it? 148. For it is no light busyness to put in a plea for the invalidation of one's own agreement, much less to obtain it by force. Then, indeed, end quote. For the decree of then, indeed, by fate, 104. The subtle body, the avenging powers of matter are set in motion against those who take the bit in their teeth, against nature sla.ws, end quote. And in are the so-called these, truth, trials, which the sacred stories, Hierologos Hercules underwent, and any other hero who valiantly strives for freedom, until they succeed in raising up their spirit to a height where the hands of nature cannot reach it, end quote. But if the leap borders, the spirit is dragged down, and there is need of, still, more grievous struggles. Property already belongs to another than ourselves. Moreover, if the soul abandon the ascent in despair, she demands penalties for the attempt. End quote. 11. In all lives are in 140s. General error if the soul does not return along its first path. End quote. And see how vast a middle state this spirit has in which to play the part of citizen. End quote. No whiff is made within her, for she is merciless, since the downward, one the copy, Platt, Phaedra, 247 Fi, the soul, verge one. The is the antithesis of the radiant body 105 1, sacred utterance, logos, tells us, that, the spirit is weighed down and sinks, until it light upon the black red gloom wrapped land, end quote. But if strive, the soul upward, the spirit also follows with it, as far as ever it has the power to do so, end quote. This it can do until it comes to the furthest limit of the region opposite, sc. to the abyss. Hear what the oracles say also on this point, end quote. End quote. Thou shalt leave no dross of matter in the height. The image also hath a portion in the light-wrapped land, to light-wrapped gloom-wrapped region, with the asterisk thing more in these words, end quote. For it is not that to seemly, for soul restore to the spheres the nature, sc. the spirit which descended thence, without any addition, but whatever of the purest strata one sharp eyes, moreover, we might see even some 438, sc. the oracle quoted above, Grawl, p. 61, see the writer S. Colchin Oracles, 2, 81. 106. The subtle body of both fire and air it drew into the image nature in its descent, before it was enveloped in the earthy shell. This also, the oracle says, it restores with it to the better asterisk portion. End quote. Moreover, it is reasonable that which share in a common nature and are counted as one should not be altogether without relation to one another, and especially things that have a neighboring territory, as, for instance, fire follows next on the circle body, sc. the ATHER sphere, and not as earth the last of existing things. End quote. And if the to the lower get some enjoyment out of the intercourse, and eventuate as a body of unadulterated mud, as though the former had been assimilated by that which was permitted to dominate in the conjunction, perhaps the lower elements as well, if they no longer struggle against the activity of the soul, but obey the reins and become submissive by keeping step with it, and allowing the middle nature to follow the guidance of the first without pulling in one mud equals water, and as to air out fire above earth, oppose higher elements by yielding things. End quote. But as to the corporeal essence that the radiant body 107, every direction may become etherealized and restored on high together with it. At any rate, if not to the whole height, they may pass beyond the highest point of the four lower elements and experience the light-wrapped land. For, the oracle says, it has a portion in it that is in some order of the circling ether. End quote. As to the that comes from the part elements, enough has been said, and we can believe it or disbelieve, as we choose. Comes thence, sc. From the etheric spheres, it is quite impossible in nature that, when the soul returns above, this essence should not arise from the corpse, and rising together with the soul, be made accordant with the spheres, that is to say, be refunded as it were into its proper nature. End quote. 12. 141c. Accordingly, these at wall allotments, the asterisk light wrapped, gloom wrapped, are the extremes, having as their portions the heights and depths of bliss and misery. End quote. And how many regions between, think you, are there in the main body, cutus of 108, the subtle body, the world, partly light and partly dark, in all of which the soul together with the spirit may live, changing its forms, and habits and lives. End quote. And so if nobility, it is a storehouse of truth, for it is pure and transparent and immaculate, God and prophet, if it so will. End quote. But if it fall down, it becomes misty, and grows indefinite, and is false, for the mist-like part of the spirit cannot contain the activities of all the orders of existence, but being between the two extremes, it misses some and hits others. End quote. You might thus judge of the demonic nature also in any of its grades. 142a. For to speak truth absolutely or all but truth is characteristic of the divine or all but divine, whereas deception and prediction is ceaseless on the part of those who grovel towards matter, deception a thing of passion and of vain glory. The soul returns to its native end quote, for it is means of this always by demonic nature that the lineage of the soul takes on the nature both of God and of Major Daimon, and leaps up into end. The radiant body 109 takes possession of the land made ready for the higher nature. Ampersand QUOT. What the nature of the radiant body was in the beliefs of the later Platonic school has now been made sufficiently clear, I hope, from the above quotations. There may be other pertinent passages with which at present I am unacquainted, for the literature is extensive, but enough have been adduced, I venture to think, to bring out clearly the main conception. We pass now from what the philosophers thought to what Christians have taught on the subject. There were philosophers also among the Christians whose lamps may still be found to throw light on what otherwise must remain in the obscurity of miracle and dogma. The resurrection body. The resurrection, so runs the general creed of end quote. I believe in of the flesh. Ampersand QUOT, Christendom. In the Eastern symbol, this appears as, end quote. I look for the resurrection of the dead. Ampersand QUOT, the Western, end quote, all, affirms men shall rise again with their bodies. One quunkunk, this is the Catholic faith. Ampersand QUOT, the intention of the first and third declarations in the popularly called Creed and Athanasian Creed Apostles respectively is plain enough. The resurrection body is to be the restored physical body. The Nicene symbol is less explicit. It in one both the old Latin form, 5th century, of the Apostles' Creed have flesh, carrots, sar jfds, The Aquileian form, Rufinus, 390 AD, and the form of Saint Nestas, 458 AD, have of this flesh, hujus carnes. The Nixeno-Constantinopolitan symbol, in the received form of the Eastern Church, dating from 381 AD, has resurrection of the dead, Anastasia Necron. But the original acta of the Nicene Council omit this clause altogether. The symbolum quoconque reads together with Iarbides cum corporibus mis, 5th century, 110, and the received. Identity theory Tertullian. Is the Latin father theresurrection body 111 tense itself with the hope of resurrection only, without further definition. On the nature of the happening hoped for in this fundamental belief of the Christian faith, there has been, since the earliest times, the greatest difference of opinion. Omitting for the moment all reference to the views of the first two centuries, the best-known advocate of the absolute physical writing in the earliest years of the 3rd century, this great controversialist, lawyer and formalist triumphantly concludes his treatise on the resurrection of the flesh with the most positive declaration possible that the flesh, that is the physical body, shall resigien in the cogiafebrion the very same flesh in its absolute identity and in its absolute one, the materi categorically. In subsequent controversies the more spiritual view is chiefly connected with the one in quote, resurgetigitur caro, equidem omnes, equidem ipsa, equidem integral decem. Res. 59, ed. Groyman, 1906 Corporation. Script. Lat. Acad. Vind. Volume 47. Integrity. Frankly allistic view could hardly be stated more. 112. The subtle body name of origin. Itis jusimitimus called the asterisk Alexandrian view. But it can hardly be correctly limited by such a designation, for Origen based himself directly on Paul, and indirectly on many a philosopher and mystic who was not of Alexandria. Unfortunately, this great thinker's treatise on the resurrection is lost, but from one we can recover a passage from Book IV, which is too highly instructive. Origen, Jerome tells us, called the Halder's letter of Jerome to Pammonicius, of the materialistic view Sargas, flesh lovers, innocence et rusticlus, in Greek of course. This would seem almost to indicate that they could not then have been a very important body in the Christian world. Origen, however, was equally opposed to another extreme view which he avers, 1 E.P.S. Haron, 38 ad Pamach, 2 C. Ramers, in his Des Origines Larivander offers the younger flashes, Trier, 1851, is hard put to it to reconcile this passage with his interpretation of isolated statements fuaoid elsewhere in Origen's works. For a sketch of the history of the subsequent controversy, see the Resurrection Body, a study in the history of doctrine, in the Church Quarterly Review, April, 1909, XVI, 138-163, symbolizes, Philo. The resurrection body. 113 would have it that the resurrection body was to be of a purely phantasmal nature, the theory of extreme Gnosticism. This, he declares, was the view of a number of the Gnostic schools, though we doubt whether it can be fairly stated quite so crudely. In some respects, this Gnostic seemed to have held views on this subject very similar to those of Origen himself. What, Origen begins by asking, is the use, in the resurrection, of a body of flesh, blood, sinews, and bones, of limbs and organs for functions of the flesh, such as eating and drinking, excretion and procreation? Are we to continue to do all these things for eternity? The promise is far otherwise. Neither the matter nor the form will be the same. There is, however, a real continuum of individuality, a substantial ground of personal identity. Hidden in the seed of the tree is the principle, ratio, logos, of the tree. This is the formative power, virtus, dynamis, in the seed, the spermatic principle, which is called symbolically in Greek spintherismos, H. One you the subtle body. What the precise meaning of this last term maybe is difficult to say, for the lexicons are silent. It means emission of sparks, sparking, literally light spark or light emanation, as is well known, is used by a number of Gnostic schools as a symbolic expression for the germ of the spiritual man. By Origen, however, it is used generally as the invisible principle of the visible seed, that which determines the nature of the visible seed. It seems to be conceived of as a substantial something, for in it, in the case of human bodies developed from this germinal ground, is said to inhere the immemorial principles of resurrection. It is likened to the innermost part or pith of plants, and is called by Origen, in the Cajovman, the nursery or seed plot, seminarium, of the dead, that is, the ground from which they will rise. It is the substance of many bodily forms for man, or the essence of human embodiment, and not only of the body of flesh, the body of the resurrection, according. The resurrection body 115 to Origen is to be of a supernal spiritual nature. Indeed, elsewhere calls it divine. End quote. Another and the real body, spiritual one, is promised us, a body that is not subject to physical touch, nor seen by physical eyes, nor burdened with weight, and which shall be metamorphosed according to the variety of regions in which it shall be. End quote. In that the whole of us will see, the whole hear, the whole serve as spiritual body hands, the whole as feet. Ampersand QUOT, it will be a radical change of schema, or plan, says Origen, quoting Paul. If the stories of the risen body of Jesus being sensible to touch and eating food are here objected, Origen replies that the Master made it appear so in order to strengthen the faith of the doubting disciples. From this time onwards the controversy became more and more embittered. Speaking very roughly, and bearing in mind a number of exceptions on either side, the materialistic interpretation dominated the Western or Latin, and the spiritualistic the Eastern or Greek Church. 116. The subtle body. After hesitation, Augustine in the West adopted, in its full sense, the physical view. By the time of Gregory the Great, at the end of the 5th century, this had become so firmly established that the philosophical Eastern interpretation could safely be condemned as utterly heretical, and so it continued throughout the Middle Ages. Though the Reformers rejected the dogma of transubstantiation in the Eucharistic sacrament as being, in spite of the subtle ties of the schoolmen, of a too material nature, Vedra nevertheless strangely enough took over practically without question the naive physical view of the nature of the resurrection body. Thus Article IV of the Anglican Church, in complete accord with Tertullian, reads, end quote, Christ did rise truly again from the dead, and took again his body, with flesh, bones, and all things appertaining to the perfection of man as nature. Ampersand QUOT. Of more recent years, however, with the application of an improved method to biblical study and a better knowledge of the history of the evolution of dogma, the pendulum has been swinging strongly in the direction of a more spiritual and one philosophical view. Indeed, it is not too much to say that it is difficult for some of us to meet with anyone of culture nowadays who believes in a crude physical resurrection. The purely rationalistic treatment of miracles, however, based on the prejudices of an exclusively materialistic view of science, which has played so prominent a part in liberal theology during the latter half of the 6th century, is no longer in fashion. Latterly, there have been marked signs of a desire in religious circles to reconsider the whole question by the light of an improved psychology, which shall endeavor to take all the facts of human experience into consideration without prejudice. A scientific psychology of religious experience is being inaugurated. The data want to see the interesting and instructive paper by Firmin Nicolard. La Resurrection de Jesus et la Critique de Pyramiris, in Review de Vie Eastward des Religions, Torn, L.I.X., No. 3, Majuin, 1909, pages 318-332. R. died in 1768. His notes on the subject were first published, among other fragments of his writings, by Leasing, at Wolf and Tittle, in 1777. 117. 118. The subtle body of psychophysical and psychical phenomena are being busily collected, both from present experience and from the accounts of similar experience in the past, and these data are being submitted to a searching analysis. It is abundantly evident to all who have followed such inquiries without prejudice that the study of similar varieties of psychical religious experience is a necessary pre to considering adequately any theory of the nature of the resurrection body. Moreover, the analysis of the New Testament documents touching the nature of the risen body of Jesus shows us that already in the beginning there was a strong difference of opinion. In spite of all efforts at canonization, there is little doubt that the general intention of the synoptic writers and the general view of the Pauline documents are at open variance. The intention of the synoptic evangelists is plainly to lay stress on the physical reality of their embody. Their attention of the stories of the empty tomb, the taking of liminary, the resurrection body, 119 food, etc., all indicate the anxiety to make it clear that the body that was raised was the identical body that suffered death. In the fourth gospel, XX 14 Z 4, however, the stories of the difficulty to recognize Ion and of in the appendix to Mark is V 12, of a changed form, indicate quite as clearly another view. The belief in the resurrection of the actual physical body was by no means the belief of the majority of the Jewish populace of the time. Nevertheless, the Orthodox rabbis presumably were compelled to hold that a living physical body could ascend or be taken to heaven, for the scriptures affirmed that the bodies of Enoch and Moses and Elijah had so been taken up. Still further, they believed that the miracle of revival, of restoration to life of the dead, had been wrought through Elijah, Elisha, and Ezekiel. Indeed, we learn from the Talmuds that belief in such wonder-working not only extended to what had been done in the past, complete non-recognition, 120, the subtle body, but that it was held to be a present posse ifk, was one of the main articles of Pharisaic faith. Of the seven classes of Pharisees, the most holy were those who were Pharisees one from pure love to God, or pious. There was a gradual growth in holiness, or sanctity, of 10 degrees, the 10th stage being the power of prophecy. But even beyond this, there was the consummation of the spiritual powers of healing to the sick and raising the dead. The early Jewish Christians of every grade, then, it is to be supposed, should have been aware of the similarity between the works of revival and the ascension wonders related of the ancient prophets and those claimed on behalf of Jesus. Apparently, they held that the resurrection of the body of Jesus was absolutely unique. If we ask in what this wide difference, 1-8 Bab, Abodisera, 20 and Emp, Lt, Z, there are no less than 5 recensions of this Bariatha, 2 in the Ger, and 2 in the Bab, Talmud, and 1 in Midrashiba. This tends to prove that the tradition is ancient, angelic, a high Talmudic authority, unhesitatingly declares that it is ability, Ger, Berachot, X 5, copy, Sada, V 5, description of Essenism, for these Heseldom, yet. The resurrection body 121 consisted, the reply of conservative traditional scholarship is practically that all the statements of the Gospels are to be taken as equally authentic and authoritative. In the case of the revival wonders, they aver, the dead who were restored to life were restored to the identical body subject to all its previous conditions. But in the case of the resurrection of Jesus, the body was the same yet not the same. Generally speaking, it was identical. But in some ways it was released from material conditions, e.g., it could pass through closed doors. It might here be objected that the body of Elijah was equally the same and yet not the same. Indeed, there is no question of identity at all, for Elijah had not died. His body was in some way released from material conditions is to be understood, for he is related to have been taken to heaven in a chariot of fire. If, on the other hand, we seek the aid of a more liberal criticism, we find that, however, 122 the subtle body, that the frankly material elements of the resurrection narratives are rejected as unhistoric. It may be objected by believers in the absolute historicity of the whole of the narratives that this is an a priori judgment. That, however, is more or less true whatever view is taken. It is indeed difficult to see how the writers of the New Testament documents also, with the possible exception of Paul, who reports his experience at first hand, can be fairly excluded from this disability. It is, therefore, necessary to inform ourselves as to the views of the contemporaries of the earliest Jewish Christians and of the evangelists on the subject of the resurrection. As has been already said, the belief of the populace was presumably largely of a material nature. The general resurrection was to be a return to life under physical conditions in order to participate in the messianic kingdom on earth. But the grossest form of this expectation was entertained only by the most ignorant, and cannot fairly be attributed even to the resurrection body 123 mass of the people. For more spiritual views had already spread far and wide. Among the hostile Mendesans, among the cultured of the Pharisees, this is to be seen among apocalyptic writers who were strongly influenced by Persian ideas, such out-and-out materialistic views had long been abandoned. It is then exceedingly probable that more popular views also had undergone considerable change in the last century BC, referring to the general development during this period of eschatological ideas, that is of belief in the latter things, the end of the world and of man. Professor Charles, than whom we have no greater authority, tells us in quote, especially on S-Chat. Of an eternal messianic king hopedom on the present earth is all but universally abandoned. Theoorthositis is manifestly regarded as wholly unfit for the manifestation of this kingdom. Q.U.O.T. The views of the last century BC on the resurrection show a great development on with whom the resurrection is to be entirely spiritual, those of the preceding century. That 124 the subtle body with others there is to be a resurrection of asterisk the body of the righteous, only this body is to be a garment of light, and those who possess it are to be angelic. More generally prevalent, the resurrection involves the spirit alone, or the righteous are to rise vestured with the glory of God, or with their former body, which is forthwith to be transformed and made like that of the only held the more spiritual view of the resurrection, but also that, instead of away with the first AD end quote, the transcendent view of the risen righteous becomes century angels. Q.U.O.T. Alexandrian writers and the essence not the resurrection and shield end quote. The Hades, in entrance of the righteous spirit on the blessed immortality is to follow on death immediately. Q.U.O.T. Here then we have a variety of views, from the gross materialism of the populace to the high spiritualism of the mystics and Ariologio philosophers. The view of the synoptic writers most strongly favored is in consonance with the crudest belief of the people. Resurrection Body 125 The doctrine of the body of glory is the doctrine of Paul. It was no doubt confirmed in him by his own personal experience in his vision of the Master. We know how strongly opposed Paul was to the after-the-flesh doctrine. He himself at any rate made no attempt to harmonize himself with it. Paul's doctrine as to the resurrection body is summarized by Professor Charles as follows, end quote. This is as in present body psychical organ of the psyche or soul, just as the risen or spiritual body is an organ of the asterisk spirit, end quote. Thus is the psychical body corruptible, and clothed with humiliation and weakness, the spiritual body will enjoy incorruptibility, honor and power, end quote. Hence, between the bodies, there is no exact continuity. The existence of the one depends on the death of the other. End quote. Nevertheless, there is some essential likeness between them. The essential likeness proceeds from the fact that they are successive expressions of the same person. 126. The subtle body, though in different spheres, It is the same individual vital principle that organizes both .QUOT. If then among cultured and mystic Hebrews there were high views of the resurrection body, equally so among the better informed of the early Christians are similar views found. Not only Paul but many other early Christian mystics, notably the Gnostics, held views that we can hardly doubt were based on experience, and which seemed to throw light on the problem. Now it is to be noted that Tertullian, D.R.C. 19, is specially annoyed with those whom he opposes, pars diversa, because they say the resurrection is to be taken in a spiritual sense. These he stigmatizes as allegorists, and contends that they would make it all a purely figurative thing. They say, he end quote, that death is asserts, really not the separation of body and soul, but ignorance of God, whereby the man being dead to God lies buried in error, as though in the grave. Q-U-O-T. Not only so, they say, but end quote, that the only resurrection worth THE resurrection body 127 considering is when on the coming of truth the man, reanimated and made alive again by God, casting off the death of ignorance, burst forth from the grave of the old for the Lord himself likened the scribes and Pharisees to asterisk white net sepulchres. End quote. Whence it follows that men, who have attained the resurrection of faith, are with the Lord when they have put him on in baptism. Q-U-O-T, Tertullian, who was himself subsequently condemned for the heresy of Montanism, for he continues, characterizes such beliefs as the asterisk mysteries, arcanalis heretica. They seem, however, in their general outlines, not to have been secret teachings, but widely of heretics proclaimed, end quote. Indeed the majority, plerique, though claiming that there is a resurrection of the soul after its departure from the body, interpret the coming forth from the grave as from the asterisking as much as escaping world. The world is the dwelling place of the dead, that is, of those who know not God, or even as the escape from the body the 128. The subtle body itself, because the body also like a grave keeps the soul shut up in the death of the worldly life. Q-U-O-T. But for the spiritually experienced this was a very real happening and not an arbitrary interpretation, as Tertullian would have it. In some schools indeed it was associated with the first true initiation into the arcana of the spiritual life. If, for instance, we interpret the short passage of Irenaeus, IXX 3, 5, which summarizes the teachings of the Gnostic Menander, by the light of recent religio-historical research and by what we know of the nature of the main psychology of the Gnostic schools, the view of the majority will be more clearly seen. Menander, who was strongly imbued with Chaldeo-Magian mystery lore, and stood on generally the borderland between it and Christian doctrines, taught that the chief end of the Gnosis was the overcoming of the world and its asterisk rulers. This could be achieved only by means of the resurrection, that is to say, by being brought into immediate contact with the saving power general. THE resurrection body 129 through 1 in whom that spirit was already active by means of a baptism which must have been of a spiritual nature, for it was believed to bestow upon the recipient an earnest of immortality and of eternal youth, and this could not very well apply to the physical body. The clearest form of the teaching to which Tertullian refers, however, is to be found in the composite Gnosian document 1 quoted by Hippolytus v. 7ff. Speaking of the primal spiritual man, the pagan commentator, who is certainly pre-Christian of the Greek mystery hymn that forms the text of the whole exposition, tells us that this immortal man is buried in mortal man. We learn further, 8, that, in their end quote, they call him Phrygian's mystery teaching, also dead when buried in the body, as though in a tomb or sepulchre. On this the Christian Gnostic writer, who years afterwards commented on the pagan and Jewish commentators who had preceded 1/4 the analysis of this document, see me thrice Greatest Hermet, I. 142ff. 180. The subtle body hymn adds two quotations, either from some lost mystic gospel, or can it possibly be, even from a lost collection of sayings, as follows, end quote. This is what is said, end quote. Ye are whited sepulchres, one filled with the bones of the dead, for man, the living one, is not in you, end quote. And he again says, end quote, the dead shall graves, that is, from their earthly bodies, regenerated, spiritual, not fleshly, end quote. This is the resurrection that takes place through the gate of the heavens, through which all those who do not pass remain dead. Ampersand QUOT. We thus see that the resurrection is equated with the new birth or birth from above, the spiritual birth out of or through the pure virgin substance into the consciousness of immortality. The same Phrygians again called this very same one as pagan commentator continues, end quote, the leap forth from there what underlies Mount XX3, LK, she, 44 and XX3, 3, 27, copy, rat underlies Mount XB, 52, 53, THE resurrection body 131, man or man, after the transformation, God or God. Ampersand QUOT, and on this the Christian writer notes, end quote, for he becomes God when, rising from the dead, through such a gate, he shall pass into heaven. Ampersand QUOT, the mystery of divinizing, apotheosis, or transcending death at Lyonesa was not, however, to be deferred to post-mortem existence, though it had to be preceded by a mystical death. It was a mystery wrought in the living body of a man. With such spiritual rites and operations, the members of most of the Christian Gnostic schools seem to have been familiar. What, however, many of them sought to do was to introduce a unique element in the case of Jesus. But naturally there was much earnest debate. Thus we are told that even in one and the same school opinion was divided as to the mystery of the spiritual resurrection in the case of Jesus. The Valentinian movement was so divided. In its Western tradition, hip. Vi. 35, Jesus was said to have had, like all men, a widespread. 182, the subtle body, psychic body, that is a fleshly, mortal vehicle of the soul. The resurrection from the dead was operated by the baptism of the Spirit. The popular story of the descent of the dove signified the descent of the Spirit, which they regarded in this connection as the Logos or supernal wisdom. The descent of the Spirit was the resurrection or coming to life in consciousness in the mortal man of the spiritual man. The Eastern tradition, on the other hand, refined the uniqueness of Jesus to the utmost. Thakin's and Ethedbo of Jesus already from birth was the spiritual body. Now though this body from one point of view was the most real of all substantial things, from the physical standpoint, it was an appearance, and therefore the Eastern Valentinians were regarded as extreme Gnostics. In brief, it may be said that all the Gnostic schools repudiated the doctrine of a fleshly resurrection, and centered their interest in a more immediate and spiritual interpretation of the mystery. When we say spiritual, however, it is of THE resurrection body 183 course, not to be supposed that this means a condition of things absolutely removed from all possibility of manifestation. That is, spiritual in an absolute sense, as entirely divorced from everything other than itself, if such a thing be possible. To Paul the asterisk is spiritual body according not a body of pure spirit, which would be, philosophically speaking, an absolute contradiction in terms, but a body capable by its purity of manifesting the immediate power of the Spirit. This, the fleshly, psychic body, he believed, could not do. The spiritual body was a glory, a body of power. In the Gnostic post-resurrectional gospel, known as Pistis Sophia, we have a magnificent description of the perfect body of glory of the Master, the vesture of light, which is practically the vehicle of all the supernal powers of the universe. In the Syrianistic hymn of the soul, or hymn of the pearl, the robe of glory is sealed with the names or powers of the divine hierarchy from the King of Kings downwards. 184. The subtle body. Many of these sublime descriptions are, no doubt, largely conditioned by the feeling that the physical body is a thing of dishonor or, at any rate, of humiliation. But this cannot really be so as viewed in the greater life. And so, in spite of the crudity of the belief in the resurrection of the actual physical body, there seems to be at the back of it a dim intuition of a certain angry truth, namely, that while man must embrace the corporeal as well as the psychic, the mental and the spiritual. Did the mystics then believe that there was an absolute divorcement in every sense between the physical or material vehicle and the spiritual body of the resurrection? It seems already pretty evident that they did not do so. Tertullian's contention that the interpretation he opposes is merely what might be termed the reification of a metaphor, or even at best an immaterial moral regeneration, as many may regard it today, is not, apparently, what was believed. Most of the mystics, at any rate, held that in the spiritual rebirth something most resurrection body 185 real in all senses, some substantial as well as moral change, was wrought in them. If we read them aright, they believed that, with truly spiritual repentance, or the turning back of the whole nature to God, that is with effective moral regeneration, the actual body or ground of resurrection was substantially brought to birth in them. Was this, then, simply some subtle body of identical or even somewhat changed physical form, capable of manifesting more extended powers than flesh? Yes and no. It was not a body in any order of subtle bodies in immediate sequence with the physical body, of which so much is heard among the psychics of all ages. It was rather the source of every possibility of embodiment, the germ ground, or seminarium, from which all such bodies could be produced. Now some have attempted to interpret the dogma of the resurrection of the physical body according to the belief in reincarnation, and so would have the resurrection body to asterisk be again rising of the flesh in the 186 the subtle body form of a new physical body in a subsequent physical life. It is true that many of the Christian as well as pagan Gnostic schools believed in one transmigration, or transcorporation, held, however, that the body of the resurrection was a body of freedom and not a body of bondage. The great change wrought at their resurrection was fundamental. It freed men from the constraints of fate, from dominion of rulers. Fortunately, we possess a mystery ritual, or rather the ritual of a mystic rite of personal religion, that gives us clear indications of the direction in which we should look to envisage the nature of this resurrection body. If purports to be the innermost rite of the Mithraica, and reference has already been made to it in the poem, from it we learn that it was fundamentally quintessential. It was one it may be of interest here to note in correction of certain popular but erroneous statements which are becoming very prevalent, that church fathers in Nicomachus teach reincarnation. A few, like Origen, put forward the doctrine of the pre-existence of the soul. But Origen explicitly and vigorously condemns the doctrine of transmigration or transcorporation, the characteristic dogma of the reincarnationists. Perfect body the resurrection body 137 primarily differentiated into simple subtle elements, whereas the physical body was conditioned by the gross mixed elements. It is by means of this perfect body that the new birth into immortality is consummated. That this is so may be seen from the opening invocatory utterance of the ritual, which runs as follows, end quote, O primal origin of my origination, thou primal substance of my substance. First breath of breath, the breath that is in me, first fire, God given for the blending of the blendings in me, first fire to fire in me, first water of my water, the water in me, primal earth essence of the earth, the essence in me, thou perfect body of me. End quote. It seemed to, if, verily, may good you, translate me, now held in my lower nature, unto the generation that is free from death. End quote. In order that presses on me, I may have vision of the deathless source, by virtue of the deathless water, by virtue of the deathless solid, and by virtue of the deathless air. that, beyond end quote, in order that I may become reborn in the insistent need. 188. The subtle body mind, in order that I may become initiate, and that the holy breath may breathe in me, end quote, in order that I admire the may holy fire, that I may see the deep of the new dawn, the water that doth cause the soul, and that the to thrill jaber which surrounds all things may give life, bestowing me the above are but a few rough notes on a theme of intense interest and enormous importance. They might be largely added to and developed to very considerable length. I should, however, like to add a paragraph from Kohler's article in the Resurrection in the Jewish Encyclopedia, which may be of interest for those who are unacquainted with the state of affairs in Reformed Judaism, end quote. In modern times, the belief in resurrection has been greatly shaken by natural philosophy, and the question has been raised by the Reform rabbis and in rabbinical one hearing .quot conferences whether the old liturgical one Dietrich A. Animitlerus Liturgy, Leipzig, 1903, C.I.A. Mithriac Ritual, London, 1907. The Resurrection Body 189 formulas expressing the belief in resurrection should not be so changed as to give clear expression to the hope of the immortality of the soul instead. End quote. This was done in all the American Reform prayer books. At the rabbinical conference held at Philadelphia, it was expressly declared that the belief in the resurrection of the body has no foundation in Judaism, and that belief in the immortality of the soul should take its place in the may. We venture to hope that Christian ecclesiastics also may be no less courageous in setting their house in order, even if they do not, as we hope they will not, go so far as the Reform rabbis in rejecting entirely all notion of a resurrection body. There seems to be another way out, as we have tried to indicate. Liturgy.quot. Epilogue. Whoever has read so far, has now before him the three sketches which illustrate the main purpose of our thesis. This purpose was to outline the most characteristic features of the doctrine of the subtle body as it was limned by those old masters of philosophic and mystic lore who were held in highest repute in Western classical antiquity, and whose views we may still regard with respect. The treatment in detail stands out from the roughly washed re-background of the poem, which is intended solely to suggest the vast expanse of the general subject and the dim distances back to which it stretches. The whole is a booklet and not a volume, an essay and not a treatise. The severest of treatment has had to be exercised in all respects, and great watchfulness to be maintained to prevent the economy. 140. Epilogue 141. Pen running off into many a tempting disquisition. And indeed it is not always an easy matter to decide what is subordinate and what is essential in pursuing the intricacies and unraveling the complexities of a subject so little surveyed in our own days, and in which the values have been as yet so superficially considered as the subtle embodiment of the life of the mind. I fear I have but scanty skill in popular exposition and no gift for descriptive writing, but I have tried to remember throughout that the subject is intensely human, and as such of no little interest for the general reader, as well as for the philosopher and scientist and the student of the comparative history of religion. Sufficient indications have, I hope, been given for the learned to pursue the matter for themselves, should they be minded to do so. Many of them are so much better equipped technically than myself for the spade work of the task that they could, if they would, turn out most valuable contributions on special points and define many. 142. The subtle body, a subordinate problem with a clarity that would go halfway to its solution. The general reader, however, is not a specialist and but little minded to apprehend the labors of technical research. Indeed, the detailed work of specialists, and most of all the unattractive form in which it is almost invariably presented, scare him away at the very first sight as a matter of no interest for his immediate needs, and as having no bearing on his daily life. I hope I have not frightened any away by the modicum of reference and annotation with which this booklet is equipped. and which may be so easily skipped. Above all, I have had in mind those ever-increasing numbers who in very various and popular ways are having their attention drawn to certain classes of phenomena of a psychical nature, which are occurring today in manifold multiplicity. These are, generally speaking, as old as the world, yet the uninstructed regard most of them as startling novelties. On all sides, we are hearing of telepathy, telergy, clairvoyance, clairaudience, psi. Epilogue 148. Cometry, mesmerism, hypnotism, suggestion, and autosuggestion, automatic writing, TRANOE phenomena, mediumship of every variety, multiple personality, exteriorization of sensibility, psychical materialization, communication with the departed, visions and drafts, dream psychology, the psychology of the abnormal, with all its manifold complexities and well-nigh inexhaustible data, psychoanalysis, psychical research, psychotherapeutics, mental and spiritual healing of every kind, and so on and so forth. The atmosphere is thick with rumors of psychism, spiritism, theosophy, occultism, Christian Science, New Thought, magic and mystery and mysticism of every grade. The dead have come forth from their tombs and the veil of the temple was rent once again in these days of catastrophic upheaval. In scientific circles also, what is now known as the new psychology has been forced to take notice of some, at any rate, of the supranormal phenomena underlying all this psychical ferment. An impression is 144. The subtle body, being slowly made even upon the 6th century type of mind that is still so influential in official circles. Now, in my opinion, it is precisely this leading notion of a subtle body, which for so many centuries has played the dominant role in the traditional psychology of both the East and the West, that is most deserving of being retried, reviewed and revised, to serve as a working hypothesis to coordinate and explain a very large number of these puzzling psychical phenomena. It is being already frankly so employed by a number of competent students outside the ranks of those who arrogate to themselves the status of being the only genuine representatives of official science, and it is eagerly accepted by hosts of people who make no pretense to any technical scientific proficiency, but who have had first-hand experience of some of the phenomena. Many, if not most, of the latter are under the impression they are accepting a new notion, dealing with a new discovery. I hope, however, that those few of them who may chance to read this essay, may be. Epilogue 145. Persuaded that, so far from this being the case, they are simply being convinced today by personal experience of the legitimacy of one of the oldest persuasions of mankind. It is true that science must advance slowly, and that this advance must be of a corporate nature. Science must rigidly test every step it takes by the most careful procedure it can command, before it can be sure its feet are planted on safe ground. For my part, however, I cannot see how this particular step is so hazardous even for the irreconcilable foes of everything they cannot test physically by the most normal avenues of sense. For those who take up so intransigent an attitude, however, I venture to think, the subtle body theory will always prove to be a potent presence haunting the threshold of that materialism from which in the belief of its devotees all superstition, as they deem it, has forever been banished. For this hypothesis comes into operation immediately with the patently physical phenomena of mediumship which supply psychical research with its most objective stratum of material. 146. The subtle body, but this lowest or most external grade of its manifestation is only the bottom rung of a ladder which, as we have seen, was believed with much show of reason by some of the greatest intellects and saintly characters of the past to rise aloft to heights of great sublimity. The path of this interior ascent is an ever purer way of life that leads the soul at last onto that plane of truth where science and philosophy and religion not only join hands, but blend into a single unitary gnosis that enables man to know himself in the perfect fullness of the presence of his God. London, Women's Printing Society, Limited, Brick Street, PICCADILLY, W. I.